heading down the stretch in the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. Dale Jarrett has been hot, winning two of the last three races on short tracks. He's only 153 points off the pace and was strong here in July. Martin is also a man to watch down the stretch. He's well within reach, just 97 points out. He's won three times in 97 and has four top fives at Loudon. It was a million-dollar win that propelled Jeff Gordon to the top of the points, and he too is a former New Hampshire winner. The championship battle heats up next. Temperature in the 70s, and we're set to go racing. The CMT 300 is just around the corner. The storylines of this day: Jeff Burton bothered by an inner ear problem. How much will he drive? How long will Todd Bodine have to fill in for him? Only one NASCAR Winston Cup win this season among the drivers who qualified in the top 12 positions. Starting spot is not everything, and is today Dale Earnhardt's day. He was third, or at least second here back in July, and it's a 51 race streak without a win. Maybe that ends today. We'll hear all about those stories and more, but first, let's go trackside. Curb Records recording artist and New England native Joe DiMessina with our national anthem.
On behalf of CMT, sponsors of the CMT 300.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose bright stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting, that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
has seen the young Jeffs come of age as the changing of the guard has happened. While Jeff Gordon has led the point standings, Jeff Burton has quietly tried to steal the show. Two wins in 97, including one here at Loudon in July. Burton has shown his muscle, challenging Gordon. But today will be a different story for the upstart from South Boston, Virginia.
Jeff's inner ear problem has been explained to me like this. Inside the inner ear membrane, there are tiny hair-like follicles surrounded by fluid. When you tilt your head, the fluid flows over the particles, causing them to send a message to your brain saying, straighten up. What has happened, one of those follicles is lodged in a static position, sending false messages to the brain. Thus, Jeff feels like he's off balance. He did practice the car yesterday afternoon. He's in the car right now. We want to ask him, if we can, real quickly. Jeff, how do you feel now?
Well, I don't feel real good right now. We've been, believe it or not, we've been in a golf cart all morning, turning left, trying to get to be acclimated to that. That worked yesterday, so I suspect I'll feel better once we get going than I do right now.
Best of luck to you out there. Now let's go further up pit road. Here is Matt Yoakum.
Well, Glenn, qualifying is always a crapshoot, a roll of the dice, and it happened here this weekend. Intermittent cloud cover and a new track sealer shook up the top 25 in qualifying. Inside the top 12, only one driver, John Andretti, has scored a win in 1997. Ahead, a host of drivers who look to end long winless streaks. Brett Bodine, 225 races since he last visited Victory Lane in his only win at North Wilkesboro. On the front row, Bobby Hamilton. His drought has reached 11 months. But on the pole for the second straight trip to New Hampshire is the Skull Bandit, Kenny Schrader. 194 starts since he last visited Victory Lane. He hopes to find magic today on the Magic Mile and spray the winner's champagne. But farther back in the field are a host of others, like the Man in Black, and Steve Burns is with them.
Boy, Matt, you are so right. There are drivers hungry for victory. There are seven drivers who won last year who have yet to win this year. Big names, names like Jeff Bodine, Bobby Labonte, 1996 champion, Terry Labonte, Sterling Marlin, Bobby Hamilton. Hey, how about Bill Elliott here in the 94? He hasn't won since September of 1994. But the victory drought, the winless streak that everyone's talking about, is, as Eli Gold said earlier, the Man in Black, Dale Earnhardt. It's been 51 races since he won, but here in July, he finished second. Eli Gold.
Steve, thank you very much, and welcome to New Hampshire, everybody. Glad you're with us on this busy motorsports day on TNN. Buddy Baker, one thing is for sure, starting spot, at least historically, hasn't meant everything here at New Hampshire.
There's a bunch of big guys back in the back that we expect to be up front in qualifying. Starting, four out of the five past winners here are starting 33rd or further back. Let me give you a for instance. Ricky Rudd is starting 37th, Rusty Wallace 33rd, Jeff Burton starting 37th, and Ernie Irvin starting 40th. They better hope, starting back, that they can get to the front without having any problems.
Of course, the other winner here, Jeff Gordon, is starting in 13th, and Dick Bergren, a native New Englander. Nice to be up in your part of the country here for a second time.
Oh, it sure is. This is the very first time ever that New Hampshire has had a second event. Start Your Engine Command just came off. First time ever for a second event here at New Hampshire. Every ticket was sold for this race months and months ago. Why not? A record purse. Almost $2.2 million. Fans have been filing into this place since well before dawn this morning. The crowd's fired up. We're fired up, too. That'll be a great one today, Eli.
Should be a great race here. A lot coming your way on TNN Motorsports. We're here in New Hampshire. The drag racers are in Reading, Pennsylvania, and it's all coming your way. Right here on TNN Motorsports. We're coming right back.
Nobody loves cars.
The field now on the first of three pace laps here at New Hampshire International Speedway. Kenny Schrader, who won the Busch pole here in July, and Bobby Hamilton, who started third a week ago. Best start of the year for Brett Bodine and Mike Skinner. He's the leading rookie. John Andretti with a win this season. Ricky Craven, he's won three times in Busch and Busch North Series racing here in New Hampshire. Best start of the year for Rick Mast and Wally Dallenbach, his best start at this racetrack. Lake Speed looking for his first top 10 of the season, and Bill Elliott was sixth here in July. Kyle Petty has finished eighth here a couple of times, and Bobby Labonte making his 150th career NASCAR Winston Cup start today. Jeff Gordon, the 1995 winner. Jeff Bodine, who was 10th here in July. Darrell Waltrip with four top 10s in 97. There's Mr. Excitement starting 16th. 17th is Mark Martin with four top five finishes here. And David Green still hurting just a tad from his Bristol accident. Dale Jarrett with five wins this year. And Johnny Benson will be joining Jack Roush Racing next year. Ted Musgrave was ninth last week. Michael Waltrip, six top tens this year. Steve Grissom, remember the run he had here back in July? His career best in New Hampshire. He finished fourth. And Derek Cope, who's won here in the NASCAR Busch Series. Hutch Strickland and Robbie Gordon in row 13. Row 14, Jeremy Mayfield, 11th in points right now, and Dick Trickle. Joe Nemechek was sixth last week, his first top 10 of the year. And there's Dale Earnhardt, second here in July. Gary Bradbury of Alabama, and Dave Marcus back after missing six races. Rusty Wallace won here in 93, and his brother Kenny Wallace alongside. Ward Burton and Jeff Green, that's row number 18, starting 35th and 36th. Ricky Rudd, who won here in 94, alongside Chad Little. Jeff Burton, not feeling well. He's got Todd Bodine standing by in relief, and there's Ernie Irvin, the 96 winner. Sterling Marlin, Robert Presley, Terry Labonte. They round out the starting field as we now get the one-to-go signal from atop the flag stand. The AutoZone race analysis brought to you by the more than 1,725 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And there you see the numbers pertaining to today's event. 300 laps, 317.4 miles. Mark Martin carrying cameras for us today from middle of the field, starting 17th. Mike Skinner will do likewise in the Lowe's machine. Kenny Wallace.
Ellis. He's got the cameras for us. We felt we better keep a tab on Jeff Burke now to see how he's doing. So he's going to carry the cameras for us as well. Of course, if you know your NASCAR history, you know that this was the weekend normally that was home to the North Wilkesboro Speedway. We're always down in North Wilkesboro this weekend. And as a result of that, Mike Staley, the current track president, is the grand marshal here today. And the souvenir ticket for the weekend honors Enoch Staley, now deceased, but the man behind the North Wilkesboro Speedway for all of its years. And everybody here, of course, the Bear family, 50% owners of the North Wilkesboro Speedway, paying homage to that fine charter racetrack in the North Carolina mountains that was for years home to a Winston Cup date on this very weekend. Here we go, pace cars pulling off. Glad you're tuned in to TNN Motorsports. Let's sit back and watch it together. The battle. Mike Skinner is there along with Brett Bodine. And with one lap complete, they'll now go three wide behind these fellas right there. And that's Skinner going way wide.
As you can see the in-car camera there, Mike Skinner got in the corner very hot, got outside the groove there, almost got into the outside wall.
Third line is on the bottom here. Second groove is the second preferred line. Nobody wants to be up as high as Skinner just went.
Of course, the track has changed this weekend. Temperature has really played a factor as you see Bobby Hamilton going for the lead on Kenny Schrader.
Look at Ricky Craven in the 25, the red car there on the inside, trying to get by Schrader as they head off turn two. This car has been really good for Ricky Craven all week long. You see him tucked in there very tight down the back straightaway, right behind Hamilton.
Craven has won here three times. He's won a Grand National race, a Grand National North. Two wins here. This is his 22nd start in New Hampshire. Incredible for a racetrack that's only been around since 1990.
Bobby Hamilton with the lead for a moment as we see from high above the New Hampshire International Speedway how Craven makes the inside groove work for him.
He's paving on that inside line, went down to the July race. Since then, they put a sealer in the second lane. That's not new asphalt that you see up there in the second groove. It's just a sealer, and the asphalt is very different down low. It's much smoother down low than it is up high.
That is that rock and asphalt from the island country of Trinidad that we told you about when we were here in July.
You can see right there, John Andretti in the 98 goes right by Bobby Hamilton. If you get on the outside, you just give up spots. Right now, you can't ride fast on the outside part of the racetrack.
There's Rick Mast. There's where Ken Schrader is back slid to now. That is sixth spot. Lake Speed moving nicely now. He's in ninth spot in the number nine. That red machine hugging the inside groove. There's Lake right there. Right behind, Bill Elliott challenging Bobby Labonte for a spot. The 94 and the 18, they're battling for 9th and 10th. Here come Kyle Petty in the 44 and Jeff Gordon now in your picture in 12th spot.
Raider started on the pole back in July as well. Tried a trick setup there, it didn't work. He's back to something much more conventional for today's race.
Take a look at Jeff Gordon coming off the fourth turn there and heading down the straightaway. You can see he's got great acceleration off turn four. That car has been a rocket ship down the straightaway all weekend.
Working lap number six of 300 here today.
Kyle Petty has been fast this whole time as well in that number 44.
There's Ernie Irvin in the mix there, the number 28 machine, starting way back. He's up to 34th position now. A long way to go, Matt. He's got to be kind of patient.
Patience is not the word for today, Eli. He started 40th. This is the same place where he scored his first comeback victory. But to get win number two, it's going to be a long haul today. Ernie was feeling a little nauseous and under the weather this morning. But some good news. He had to have a late morning engine.
good news, because every time the 28 crew has to change the motor, race morning, they always run well and at least score top 15 runs.
You see the 71 there. It's good to see Dave Marcus make the race this weekend. It's been quite a few weeks since he's been in a spot to even start a race, and it's good to see Dave back in the field.
Super to see Dave Marcus running right there in the number 71. Up front, the race lead still held by Ricky Craven. He took over at lap number 4. Jeff Burton still driving the XI Batteries Ford. Todd Bodine is there, standing by in relief. Driver's suit on, ready to go if needed. Back live at New Hampshire International Speedway, where Ricky Craven still leads the overhead view, courtesy of DuraShine Advanced Auto Polish. Just wipe it on, close it off. DuraShine now available at Pep Boys, Western Auto, Kmart, and Target Auto Stores. Eli Gold, Dick Bergman, Buddy Baker, Glenn Jarrett, Matt Yoakum, Steve Burns on hand here at New Hampshire International Speedway. There's the favorite son up in these parts from Scarborough, Maine. Ricky Craven took the lead at lap number 4. We are now at lap number 15. Others on the move. Dale Earnhardt creeping up towards the front. He's bypassed Dale Jarrett. He's moved around Ted Musgrave. Earnhardt now in 21st position, but that's the pace. Once, if you hook up here and you see Craven beginning to pull away, I mean, if you can hook up and get gone, it's going to be tough for guys who are running well, like Earnhardt and like the 37 right ahead of him, Jeremy Mayfield, to try and chase you down.
One of the reasons for that is this place does generally not have very many caution flags. Only 2 here in July, and 2 of the 5 Winston Cup races that have been run here before only had 6. So if you're going to pass cars here in New Hampshire, chances are you're going to have to pass them on the racetrack more than you're going to have to pass them in the pits.
Short pitting, though, certainly could be the way to go.
Especially for all those big guns that started in the back of the pack, and several of them have already talked about the possibility of not pitting at all on that first caution flag, should it occur at the right moment and should everybody else pull a stunt like that.
Flat straightaway, the turns bank 12 degrees. There you see Bill Elliott in the 94. He's in ninth. Jeff Gordon is in 10th. Kyle Petty 11th. Then Jeff Bodine and Bobby Labonte, 12th and 13th. And, of course, across the top of the screen, we'll have for you all day the scoring rundown, so you'll know who's where.
And it wouldn't surprise anybody to have Elliott have a terrific run here today. Cole at Richmond led 43 laps. Southern 500 led the most laps. His crew chief, Mike Beam, says they have come upon something in the chassis in that car. He won't even tell us what area it's in, but they've been working on it for almost a year, and they are close to getting it. Even faster in Hampshire, they might just get it today.
Meanwhile, let me take you back a minute and show you something that happened to Mark Martin. Watch Kyle Petty with problems right there. Hard on the binders. Kyle running in 11th spot. That was brake smoke you saw there.
Jeff Bodine better go pretty hard for a little while. I would think Petty wouldn't be pleased with that. He got into it just getting into turn 3 over there. Petty had to get on the brakes very hard to keep from hitting the wall.
Now here's what happened to Mark Martin a minute or so ago. I don't know if you guys even saw this up here. He and Robbie Gordon together.
Yeah, look at Jimmy Spencer. He almost got in the back of both of them.
Jimmy did a good job. You see, it looked like Hutt might have even gotten in the back of Spencer right there also. You see the front of those cars? Don't know how closely you can see. See all the extra openings there, buddy, in the front of the cars? That is something that is really right there. There's a good look at Hutt. Look at right there behind him on Mayfield. All the extra slats. That's something you don't see at every racetrack.
Eli, I talked to a lot of the crew chiefs, and they said the hardest thing about sitting up here, you can see damage on Jimmy Spencer's car there, was to actually open as much front-end openings as you have to have on these cars to cool the brakes and everything. You lose a lot of downforce, so they have a tendency to push coming off the corner. Very difficult to get these cars where they really work well.
Strong brake track for sure. Long, long straightaways, and the drivers really have to get on the binders at the end of those straightaways.
Let's point now, next time they come through, buddy, and we'll look at those extra openings. You see Hutt Strickland there battling, looking back there towards Spencer's car.
Okay, you see Spencer's car right there. They have openings on both sides there. On Major Speedway, they don't have those. They also have this part open. On Major Speedway, that's closed down, giving downforce, making the front end stick a lot better. Here, you need to cool the brakes, or you go right straight in the wall. So you have to have a lot of brakes, too.
We're 22 laps complete. Just underway in the CMT 300. Meanwhile, keeping tabs on the 99 machine, that's Jeff Burton trying to work inside of Chad Little. Again, Jeff Burton bothered by the inner ear problem we've talked about. Glenn, you talked in greater detail in the pre-race. What's he saying on the radio?
Well, Eli really hasn't said a whole lot, except he didn't say anything for about the first 10, 12 laps. Then he came on and he said, the car's tight. We need to adjust the track bar. So he's already directing these guys. So far, so good. We've been timing. He's blocking him. He's been turning lap speeds as quick as at sometimes even quicker than the leader. So right now, everything's okay. They're just going to let Jeff play it by ear. They had originally planned for him to get out at the first caution or the first pit stop. Right now, they're just going to wait and see how Jeff feels at the time. As normally, the longer he goes in the car, the better he feels.
I'm glad that's what Todd Bodine told you and I this morning. He said, I don't really think the boy is going to get out of that race car.
No, I think that's exactly right. Todd's standing here with that little smile on his face, watching me, and as Jeff was talking, Todd turned around and said, there ain't nothing wrong with him today.
Meanwhile, on the racetrack, the little bump and go there, Kyle Petty and Jeff Gordon there. They were running in the 10th, 11th, 12th positions and some close quarters racing right moments ago. We'll take a look at what happened. They were going into turn number 3. Take a look at this, folks.
Well, you see the 24 there as they start off the corner of the 7 car. Gets in the left rear. Jeff gets sideways right there. Has to check up just a little bit. But you see Bodine going by on the inside. But he's got a mirror full of somebody he ran into just a little while ago. Kyle Petty's directly behind these two cars.
All the while, Ricky Craven continues to lead. Everything else has settled down. There is Ricky, who started the year with 2 straight top 5 finishes. Since then, though, his best finish was 9th at California. Maybe today is a day he'll creep up on that and grab a victory. We're early, 26 laps complete. And there's Maine's favorite son. He's in charge now. And in light of how well you did entertaining us, I think it's only fitting now that Buddy Baker reciprocates. And here's Buddy with his,
jam,
here's Buddy with his version of Heads Carolina, Tails California.
No.
No?
I'm leaving.
No.
That, of course, one of your wonderful hits. You're not in Kansas anymore. I'll tell you, things are just going so well for you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, and being here today is quite an honor because something needs to be so intertwined with the NASCAR racing. And, of course, all of us artists are a part of CMT, the music video channel for country music. And it just seems so perfect to have the CMT sponsor a NASCAR race. We're finally getting to do something together.
Of course, Curb Records, your label, Mike Curb and those folks were keenly involved in NASCAR racing many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So that really is a wonderful relationship. Our friends at Napa giving you the NASCAR timing and scoring update across the top of the screen as you see Bobby Labonte running in the 13th spot. Mark Martin right behind him in the 14th. We ride with Mark Martin now. Coming from Massachusetts, Jody, as you have, did you ever think that this area, we are of course just in a neighboring state to your home state, do you ever think that motorsports would be this big up here in New England?
No, when I was younger we used to come up to the races, but it wasn't NASCAR, and this is a fairly new a new track here.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was living here, this wasn't here, and it's really, I think it's great that NASCAR is reaching everywhere now.
We're watching the 2 Robert Yates cars now running 19th and 20th. Dale Jarrett in the 88 and 19th spot. And Ernie Irvin right behind him coming through traffic in a hurry. Ernie, remember, started in 40th, so he's now worked himself up halfway through the field. This has been great having you with us today. Enjoy the rest of the afternoon. And I know everybody at home watches both TNN and CMT. It's been a wonderful way for the folks to enjoy those great country music videos. And best of luck to you.
Well, thank you very much.
Jody Messina joining us here at the CMT 300. She had the national anthem earlier this afternoon, and a local from the state of Massachusetts. Taking a look at Dale Earnhardt there, the number 3, working himself now in the 16th position, challenging Bobby Labonte. Glenn, we saw the
Oh, boy.
Nothing left there on the inside of that yellow line. Glenn, I was going to pitch to you about Ernie Irvin. He was making a nice move through traffic.
Yeah, Eli, he's been real fast today. In fact, he's been real fast all week. Really a mystery to everybody why the qualifying efforts were so poor. But Ernie has consistently had one of the fastest cars all week. He's talking right now. It's just a little bit tight in the middle, a little too tight for his liking. But as you pointed out, he has moved up about halfway through the field. Dale Jarrett. So Ernie was one of the guys. When I talked to the people in the garage area this morning, they all told me to just wait. Ernie Irvin will be there before the day's over. He's on his way. He's halfway there.
And here goes Dale Earnhardt now for 15th spot as he makes the pass on Bobby Labonte. And you know that 88 car, Dale Jarrett right there, you know the history of that race car, Dick Berger?
It goes way, way back. That's the car Davey Allison drove here as well. They call it Black and Decker. It's about the oldest race car in the field.
Matter of fact, that's the car that Davey drove here just the day prior to his accident and losing his life. So that is very much a special car in the Robert Yates stable. And Steve Burns, they were telling me this morning that they think it can go to the front.
Yeah, but right now, Eli, Dale Jarrett just radioed in and says they've developed the push. Now, the race here in July, the teams were chasing the clouds. It was cloudy in and out all day long. Today it's in bright sunlight. So some of the teams were concerned about their handling situations early. And Dale Jarrett has developed a small push.
So we'll follow that. Here goes Kenny Schrader now, trying to grab a spot from Wally Donovanback. That'll be fourth place, swapping around there. And how about up front? Bobby Hamilton has now cut the deficit in half. It was 2.5 seconds he was down to Ricky Craven. It is now, what you see there, under a second behind the Budweiser machine. We're early in New Hampshire on a beautiful day. 344 laps complete. Ricky Craven still leads. And watch this. Wally Donovan back there in the 46. Late speed, Bodine, Bill Elliott, Jeff Gordon. They've been beating and banging on each other for the last handful of laps. That's for 6th through 11th position.
Eli, Wally Donovan back is running like a snake without a tail on it and a heavy wind. The back end of that car is all over the place. But I tell you what, he's young, he's ambitious. He hasn't backed off a little bit yet.
It's a brand new car Dahlenbach is in, and he's doing a good job of keeping it up in front of this group. This has sort of been like a street fight out here with this collection of cars. And Earnhardt, you just saw a little bit of him. He's on his way into that mess. There's Earnhardt. Top of your screen, now on the left of your screen.
13th spot for Dale, the number three. One of you we were talking about a few minutes ago, Wally Dahlenbach and those guys keep and banging off each other. Take a look at this, and you'll get an idea of what's been going on. Ian Schrader right there.
Well, he's sideways there.
Yeah. Rick Mast.
This is Rick Mast in the 75. You see Jeff Bodine in the 7 coming up there. They've been at it for a long time. I mean, it's been a crash custom.
There goes Earnhardt around Bill Elliott. And staying there now. And Mark Martin's going to follow right through as well as you ride with the Valvoline team.
Same car Earnhardt had here in July. It's a drop snout car. That's a very different kind of chassis construction than Earnhardt is used to. He does not like a loose feeling car. This one gives the feeling of being loose. Larry Reynolds is trying to inspire in him the confidence. Don't worry about it. Just hang on to it. It'll be all right. So far, so good.
Michael Walton is in 11th, just ahead of him. And Wally in 10th.
Twice in Winston Cup competition, once in Grand National competition.
Had a great race with Ian Joe Dimmick.
That was something. Could have taken it out. Could have taken Nemechek out and didn't. He was an absolute gentleman. Nemechek won the race. Earnhardt was second.
I talked to Richard Childress just before the race today, and he said, if you make 75 laps without problems, we have the car to beat.
Meanwhile, Wally for the last 45 laps, Ricky Craven has been the race leader. Here goes Mark Martin. Here comes the battle for the lead. Remember, we're showing you how Bobby Hamilton was closing in. To realize what this day means to Ricky Craven, understand this, that in the previous 7 races this year that he has led, Craven had led a grand total of 49 laps in all of those 7 races. He's already at that same number here today as Earnhardt and Martin go by Michael Waltrip. So Michael goes from 10th to 12th in that quick exchange. Here's Bobby Hamilton, who has 16 straight finishes now of 17th or worse. Let's see there. There's Brett Bodine going a lap down. Interesting there because Brett started in 3rd, Matt Yoakum, and all of a sudden in the span of 50 laps, he's a lap down.
Eli, he was dropped all the way outside of the top 30. Last night in half yellow, he was a little bit loose. It changed the sway bar and a few other minor chassis adjustments, hoping that that will tighten him up. Obviously, it has
has it, and he's dropped a lap down. An interesting story about this car, though. We talked about the heritage of the 88 car. This car was actually for sale, had a for sale sign on it earlier in the year. They decided, hey, let's make this an R&D car. They cut off the snout, put a low snout, a drop snout on this, which helps you turn in the corner better. They said, let's try a few things on this car while it's a Thunderbird, because we don't want to do it when it's a new Taurus, because if it doesn't work, we've got to cut it all up. So they're using the rest of this season as an experimentation with a lot of different chassis points and measurements, because they've got about 8 races left to go, and use that as an R&D session.
Meanwhile, there's Ricky Craven up front. Told you the eighth time he is leading this year, eighth different event. Meanwhile, let's take a look at what happened to Dale Jarrett and Wally Dallenbach on the backstretch. Ba-boom. And a ba-boom to you.
Wally wow. Dallenbach has had people at his door all day long.
There you see Sterling Marlin in the four. He is about to go a lap down. Sterling running in 38th position, being bypassed by the race leaders. Richard Childress looking on. His man's in the top 10 now. Back the CMT 300, still under green, lap 57. Ricky Craven still showing the way after taking the lead at lap number 4. He and Bobby Hamilton battling for the top spot as they put Jeff Green a lap down. Green running in 34th position. Curious about some of the other major players. Terry Labonte didn't have a good qualifying weekend. He has now worked his way up to 28. We told you earlier about Ernie Irvin, who started back in 40th. He is now 13th. If you're a Dale Earnhardt fan, he is now running in 8th spot. Rusty Wallace, he's in 27th. He won the inaugural year back in 1993. MCI with NASCAR timing and scoring updates for you across the top of the screen. As we are 59 laps complete. There you see Jeff Burton. 33rd position now. What are you hearing, Glenn? Any problems? Any?
As they say, Eli, no news is good news. They radioed to him a while ago and told him that if he needed to, he could pit at any time. But Jeff says, I'm okay. Right now, he's pretty stable back there, running pretty consistent lap times. Talked to Todd Bernard, he says right now that Jeff seems to be okay. Doesn't really think he's going to get in. They're just playing it by ear. The first pit window that we should see should be somewhere around lap 85. That's kind of the ideal lap that they're shooting at. They might go a little further. They may stop a little sooner than that. The tires will be gone before then, but that's about when they're going to need fuel. They just told me here in Burton's pit that they would play it by the leader, that they'll probably pit under green whenever the leaders do.
And if we use that 85 lap number as a general barometer, that's still about 24 laps from now, so a good bit of racing yet to go. If you're just joining us, Kenny Schrader, who was on the pole, led the first two laps. Bobby Hamilton led lap 3. Ricky Craven took over at lap 4 and has now led more laps today than all the other races combined that he has led in 1997.
Hamilton having a good run in that number 43 car as well. He will vacate that car next year. He'll be gone. He's saving, however, at least one of his uniforms. The rest of them he's going to donate to charity where they'll auction them off.
There you see Jeff Bodine in fourth. Jeff Gordon running in fifth. Jeff Bodine with an infusion of money and new blood in his racing team. Matter of fact, in the 5 races since the new ownership, they have 2 top 5s and 3 top 10s. Amazing what a new outlook on a team can mean.
Yeah, new engines under the hood as well. Yeah. They've been trying to do their own motors and have had a lot of engine trouble. Now they've gone to the Pro Motor, Peter Giles, and seems to be working very well with them. They will be with that engine package for the rest of this year and for all of next year.
Eli, you can look at the 24 car of Gordon. He's extremely strong right in that area. Center part of the corner, this car is really working well. But it hadn't been that long ago since Jeff Bodine got in the back of the 24 car coming off turn two over there and almost turned him around.
And there goes Bobby Hamilton. He will take over the top spot, just out powering into the turn number one area. Meanwhile, Michael Waltrip will move around the 10 Schrader car. And you see Schrader in the 33 washing up the track a little bit now in 12th. He'll go to 13th as Elliott comes by. He'll move to 14th as soon as the 37 of Jeremy Mayfield gets by. Let's get an update from the Schrader pit.
Eli Kenny Schrader Chevrolet has loosened up a little bit. So what he's done, being the veteran he is, he said, guys, we're just going to ride it out. We're going to pit and run another 33 laps. So let's just ride to the pit stop, and we'll tight it up and get back to the fight. But right now, he's a little bit loose, and no need to chance the car.
Well, Kenny Schrader just taking his time, biding his time. But Bobby Hamilton, the new leader now here in the CMT 300. In 96, he led 41 laps here. Earlier this year, Bobby Hamilton led 43 laps. We were here back in July. But interestingly, his best finish in New Hampshire is only 16th. Maybe he'll be able to improve on that today. On the Speedway, we'll show you why Jeff Bodine spun, but right now let's go down to the Jeff Burton pit. Glenn Jarrett?
And it looks like the Todd Bodine will get in the car. They have, they drug Jeff. In fact, they just pulled him right out of there, almost threw him down. Bodine is in the car now. We thought they were going to wait until the next time by so they have more room, but they're making a change right now. They're strapping Todd in the car. We'll get word with Jeff in a moment. He looks to be okay, but I think they're just not going to take any chances, Eli. They just want to make sure that nothing worse happens to Jeff Burton.
Now, this is not the first time that Todd Bodine has driven here in a NASCAR Winston Cup car. Remember when the number 75 ride was his? He drove in both 1994 and 1995. In 94, he finished fifth after starting 15th. He didn't have quite as good a year with a 36th place finish in 95 with a mechanical problem, but this is not the maiden voyage in a Winston Cup car for Bodine, for Todd Bodine, here at this racetrack.
Well, Todd drove for Ricky Craven in Texas and was leading the race there and had right near the end of the race, got involved in an accident, but did a great job all day.
Now let's go to Steve Burns.
And Ricky Craven has been in for service, Eli. They changed four tires. Now this caution actually happened at a good time for them because Ricky had complained of being very loose. He was having some rubber buildup. Also, Dale Earnhardt had started 30th. He worked his way up to 7th. They took four tires as well. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Bad luck for Kenny Schrader. He came in the lap before the caution came out. He got caught on pit road. He's got a lap down. He could not hold on to the car any longer. They came in, made a two-tire pit stop, and tried to tighten him up big time with some major chassis adjustments. Also, great pit work by the STP crew. They got Bobby Hamilton out on a four-tire pit stop. They put him out into the lead. Now let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
And we're standing by with Jeff Burton. And Jeff, great job out there. Main question is, how you feel?
Well, I don't feel real good, but got this in the lead last. I'm only about 50%. Todd can do a way better job than I can do. So, it's to the sex side thing. Let somebody get in there that can drive it.
Still pretty tough to crawl out of your car, though.
Yeah, it is. But, this is a team deal. And there's times in this deal where you got to give up something you want to do to help the overall deal. And that's what we're going to do.
He did a great job. I think he did far more than anybody thought. You could hear the emotion in his voice. He did not want to have to get out of that race car, but he knew it was the best thing.
So he goes 68 laps. Now, why are we under caution? Let's take you back to lap number 67, Dick Bergwin.
Well, here we go. Jeff Bodine ahead of the number 24 of Jeff Gordon. And here we go.
Looks to me like Jeff had a little more acceleration than the 7 car of Bodine as they started off the corner. Bodine goes around. Very lucky he didn't get hit by other cars going by.
Nor did he make contact with the wall. Jeff Bodine was able to continue. But at that very second, Ken Schrader had already made his pit stop. And because of that, Kenny is a lap down now in 35th position. The Kingsman is currently on top.
Say the seat pretty much fit both of them. The biggest problem that they had was the steering wheel.
Right.
But Bodine's come back in again, tried to get himself a little bit more comfortable in the car. The miracle here is they did that driver change without going down a lap. Bodine's job now, bring that car home in one piece, collect as many points as he possibly can for Burton, who entered this event fourth in points. This is not the time for heroics. Bring it home in one piece.
Yeah, we both talked to him earlier in the garage area, and that was his big problem. He says, I want to go up. This car always runs up front, but he said, I know my job. That's to finish the race and get a lot of points.
There's Dale Jarrett as he circulates on the speed. Watch what happened to him on pit road. Watch him trying to come out of the pit stall. He's stuck in behind Derek Cope's machine.
See him coming out there, the stick trickle in the 90. Wow.
Kind of got sandwiched in there just a bit. You guys had some problems. Lake Speed had a good run going, but comes out of pit road in 17. He is among the many who have had to work through some pit road work. And there you see some of the others, how they came onto the pit lane and how they exited pit road. Earnhardt from 6th to 7th. Kyle staying even, coming in 10th and going out 10th. Field getting the one-to-go signal now. They will be going racing the next time by.
Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace are both pitted toward the back end of pit road, which is something of a disadvantage here. They may have problems with that before the day is over, trying to get in and out as quickly as they might otherwise do so were they closer to the front.
There's Ricky Craven. He has been leading for a good bit of the day. Of course, it's not been the very best year overall. There you see some of the numbers. 12th at Michigan, Steve Burns, the best finish in the last 9 races for Ricky Craven.
And Eli, the spirits are very high down here. Andy Graves, the crew chief, radioed and after the pit stop and said, hey, the first 50 laps were fun. Ricky Craven said, yeah, that's exactly how it's supposed to be. The reason is we just took a look at the tires, and they're in great shape. Let's get ready to drop the green flag.
Here they come out of turn number 4.
The car is on the inside there, a lap down. If you're wondering who's the lap down, the guys on the inside of the racetrack there are a full lap behind now.
Kenny Schrader on the tail end of the lead lap. Once everybody made their stops. Let's see if he stays there or if Bobby Hamilton will again put him a lap down.
Hamilton has done such a nice job today, but he's done a nice job at the beginning of a lot of events, and what they have really got to do today is do this good work all day long, still be there at the end of the race, running as well as they're running now. No driver announced yet for that car. In fact, they don't even have some guys that they'd like to put in a short list yet, so if you're a great race driver and want to go Winston Cup, just call Richard Petty.
Get that resume in.
Don't look at me. I don't want it. The 94 there, Bill Elliott, has moved up into third place. You know, for the last little bit, these guys have really turned it around, Dick. And Mike Beam and all of them, you know, you just hit it right on the head. They've always had great motors, but now their chassis is really at the ball game, and they're back where Bill used to be.
No, he had, what, 6 top tens in the last 7 races before that disappointment in Richmond, where he finished 30th. But he had the pole and led the most laps at Darlington. So, yeah, here in this last segment of races, outside of Richmond, things got awfully well for Bill.
Look at Ricky Craven take the lead back. He has this car hooked up. He has to be very, very proud because, as we have said, he's had a pretty dismal second half of the season. But right now, he's out front in front of his native people here, and he's very, very happy.
This racetrack has a program of championship drivers, and Ricky Craven was the very first champion the Hampshire International Speedway ever had back in 1990. And he is a local boy. He's been Concord for a while, which is right down the street from the Speedway. They all know him in this grandstand.
Now you heard the fans react when he took the lead moments ago. Just one caution if you're tuning in along the way. Nobody in the garage area as of yet. One driver change. Todd Bodine is in for the ailing Jeff Burton. Otherwise, it is as they started back at 12:45 Eastern time today.
Ernie Irvin, number 28, steady on the move of Jeff Gordon just in front of him. Ernie's had a fast car all day long. He started way back, but he has picked them off one by one. He'll be up there in front in just a few seconds. The way this car is running around the racetrack.
Ernie's in ninth now, Glenn.
Yeah, when they pitted that time, they made a couple of air pressure adjustments. Rear track bar. The car was a little tight, as we told you earlier on. I tell you what, if it it was tight and he was running like he was. If they ever get that thing right, the rest of the guys might as well pack up and go home. That is a rocket ship.
Arzerni, a winner here a year ago.
It's an interesting race strategy. He says it can all boil down to just this one thing. How much time you on the gas? So his strategy about going into the turns is, if he's with somebody else, if it's a side-by-side deal, whenever the other guy backs off, Ernie backs off a little bit later.
Here's Bobby Hamilton now.
Back and forth they go.
He's got the lead from Ricky Craven, makes it going into the corner at lap number 81. So 78, 79, and 80, led by Ricky Craven. And Bobby Hamilton puts the STP Pontiac back in front of lap number 81. Right behind the front three, actually the front two, you see Rick Mans there at the 75. John Andretti just ahead of him. Bill Elliott, Mark Martin. I'll tell you, Rick Mans is going to be tickled for him, Matt. Best qualifying effort of the year, and he's hanging right there in the top five.
They set out a goal earlier today, Eli. They wanted to do much better than they did last time they were here. They finished 28. They said today could be a really good run for us. He's running great now. The car was a tad tight off the corner, so they loosened him up just a little bit. And also about Bill Elliott, he's having a great run too. He only took out two tires for track position. He was also a tad tight. They loosened him up. Three rounds down on the track bar, and he was out, and they are both having stellar runs today.
Now, Rick Mast, the best finish he had had this year was 12th at Dover back in June. He is now doing awfully well today. How about old Earnhardt right there? He and Jeff Gordon. Oh. Before I open up my mouth about Earnhardt, he loses a couple of spots.
He's moved up to seventh. You see him just behind Ernie Irvin there in the three. He's doing a great job today, though, and I think he has a car set up for long runs. It looks that way. Right at first, a lot of these cars that run really well will drop back. Earnhardt set up for long runs, I think.
Dale was seventh until I opened my mouth. He's now ninth. Up front, Bobby Hamilton and Ricky Craven and swapping around the lead. There you see the separation between the two. Pontiac has now led in 15 of the races here in 1997. We're coming right back.
Roll on!
P300 today, brought to you courtesy of DuraShine Advanced Auto Polish. Just wipe it on and hold it off. DuraShine, now available at Pep Boys, Western Auto, Kmart, and Target Auto Stores. What a magnificent view of a beautiful racing facility. And how about that view right there of Jeff Gordon and Ernie Irvin working around the speedway. They are 7th and 8th, respectively. Setting it for you, Bobby Hamilton leads. Craven is 2nd, Andretti 3rd, Rick Mast is 4th, Bill Elliott 5th. Mark Martin is now 6th, ahead of Gordon 7th, Irvin 8th, Dale Earnhardt is 9th, and 10th now is Kyle Petty. The pole sitter, Kenny Schrader, he is not faring all that well right now as he is backslid. Even after his pit stop, he is backslid to 35th position. We've talked so much about Bobby Hamilton and Pontiac leading. There you see Hamilton in front. Those of you who may not follow all of the NASCAR rules week in and week out need to know that there was a new rule for Pontiac effective here today. A 1/4 inch increase to 6.5 inches to the height of the rear spoiler right there on the back of the car, and a 1/4 inch reduction of the front air dam height, the lower front balance, to 3.5 inches. So whether that has how much impact, we don't know, but just as a point of reference, those rules are effective here this weekend.
And they're saying about 20 pounds more downforce in the car. Buddy, could you feel that in a deal like this?
Oh, yeah. Well, what it's good for is real long run. What you can see visually right there, the nose of the Pontiac is right on the ground. The Chevrolet just behind it is up just a little bit. You can visually see that it's closer to the ground, that gives it more downforce. Also, the taller rear spoiler will plant the back of the car for forward bite. So everything is to help the Pontiac get in an even playing field.
And Matt Yoakum, I think that is basically the gist of what Bobby Hamilton was telling you earlier today, wasn't it?
That's totally correct, Ron. He told me that you won't see the result of these changes right off at the start of a run or on a restart. But when the course of the run goes to around 40 laps, you are going to see the Pontiac slowly pull away, because that's when the advantage will come in. Talk about another advantage here at Loudon. The tires today are the same tires they raced at Phoenix. Remember, the 43 car picked up their win last year at Phoenix, and this is the same type of car they had there last year. They are looking for a good run today. another victory.
And there you see some of the fellows who are moving on and how they're doing. Derek Cope, by the way, the heavy storyline in the garage area is that he has indeed found himself a home, which will be announced as early as Tuesday of this week. All the supposition is that he is going to be joining Chuck Ryder and the number 30 team effective this coming weekend. They plan, so we are told, an announcement as early as Tuesday of this week. So apparently, though there's no confirmation from within the team directly, but apparently what we're hearing, Matt, is they're going to make some kind of an announcement as early as Tuesday.
Eli, a source close to the team told me an announcement Tuesday or Wednesday. Derek Cope will be in the 30 car next season. They have a lot of big plans also to announce for next year. The source also tells me expect the Bahari Racing will also go into their own in-house chassis program, with Steve Levitt supposedly heading up the operation. As you recall, he used to work for Hendrick Motorsports, and he spent time at the 37 car.
So we'll know more about that as the week continues. You saw Ernie Irvin make a nice power move there, grabbing six spots. And here comes Mark Martin, the six, to the inside of Rick Mast. That's for fourth.
Eli, what you're seeing now is the cars that are balanced the best. So moving towards the front, Ernie Irvin is just absolutely flying. He passed Jeff Gordon just a little bit ago. He's opened up about a 12-car lap lead and has caught the group just in front of him. You can see he dropped Rick Mast down, and just in front of him, you can see the sixth car there, Mark Martin. He's catching them, I mean, like 3/10 per lap.
Hey, folks, watch this. Let's go back to 18th position now. And this took place just a moment or so ago. Watch what happened here. Nemechek and Steve Grissom. Pardon me.
Whoa.
That was the battle for 17th and 18th position when that bump and go took place on the main straightaway. Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt there has just gotten around Bill Elliott. So move Earnhardt up into eighth, Elliott back to ninth. Bill's lost a few spots here in the last handful of laps.
As I was saying, you just can't believe when the tires start going away and the downforce is not, the balance in the car is not just right on this racetrack, how fast you can go to the rear.
But Bobby Hamilton's not going to the rear. He took the lead for the third time today at lap number 81. We are now closing in on lap number 100, one-third of the way home in the CMT 300. See the lead machines at New Hampshire International Speedway, Bobby Hamilton and Ricky Craven. There you see the interval. They have been the dominant cars through the first third of the event. We're now at lap 104. Now back to the third place car. That's John Andretti in the number 98, the winner of the Pepsi 400 at Daytona back in July. Ernie Irvin, who may be the fastest car in the Speedway, is now running in the fourth spot behind John Andretti.
He's running very well. It got by Mark Martin, but he just washed out the middle part of the corner there. You see John Andretti in the 98. Here at the 28, coming down the back straightaway, lost a little bit of ground to Mark Martin. He had about a 15-car length lead. Just behind him is Jeff Gordon.
Is 10th. Steve Burns, you've been hanging out in the Mark Martin pit, I see.
Yeah, and I just talked to team manager Steve Meehl and asked if they made any adjustments. You know, they started 17th, and now they're running 5th. Steve said the only adjustment they made was to put on a new set of tires. No chassis adjustments. Mark thought he had a right front going down, but all they did was bolt on four new Goodyears, and he said they loved this set of tires.
This has not been an incident-free weekend, though, for Mark. He scuffed the wall of it yesterday. As a matter of fact, final practice, he didn't even have the number on the right side of the car. The car was naked on its right side, and they finished applying the decals following that final practice yesterday. There you see the points as they run, sponsored by Havoline. Havoline Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. They have all the stat updates for you.
Doing really, really well on this championship run this year. 97 could well be Mark Martin's best career year. He's won twice in IROC competition, three times in Winston Cup, five times in Grand National Racing. Right now, second in points. Most he ever won in a single year was five races, Eli. Yeah. This could be his best.
And he likes these kind of flat tracks. He says he doesn't like the short tracks that are flat particularly. He gets a lot of wheel spin just the way his driving style is on some of those tracks. He says he doesn't get it here. He doesn't get it in Phoenix. And that's why he's real comfortable on his big, slick
How would you like to have to close on the guy that's 6 inches off your back bumper, though? Jeff Gordon runs just as well, and that's what makes this championship so interesting, is because the talent in these two race cars that you're looking at are just unbelievable on any type of racetrack.
And the team behind both of those men as well, they're such solid teams, the Roush organization with Mark Martin and the Hendrick operation with Jeff Gordon. A lot of depth in both of those organizations.
There's old Rusty Wallace. He's up to 13th. And remember, Rusty has finished no worse than 7th in the previous 5 races here at New Hampshire International. He started the inaugural here in 33rd. He won. Matter of fact, better than 100 laps that day. Meanwhile, there you see the swap in position. Jeff Gordon has gotten around Mark Martin now. So put Gordon in 5th and Mark, with whom we are riding, back in 6th. If you're curious about Terry Labonte, he's in 24th now. There's Terry following Joe Nemechek in the 23rd spot. Terry Labonte, it's not been a stellar year for Terry. Glenwood watching him. He's making moves bit by bit, but it's taken him a while.
Yeah, that's the truth, Eli. You know, I've been spending time right now clocking some of these guys while traffic has spread out. I've been watching Bobby Hamilton. I was clocking him a couple of laps ago, and he turned it completely sideways off of turn 4, and it cost him some time on that lap and the next one. Meanwhile, I'm watching Ernie Irvin and Dale Earnhardt right now. They are consistently 1/10 to 1/15 of a second faster than anybody else in the racetrack. I just think it's a matter of time before 28-3 work their way to the front. If they have another caution, I think you're going to see those two guys battling for the lead spot.
Good point right there. And, you know, we got to clarify what I said about Terry Labonte as you watch Mark Martin now bypass Gary Bradbury. Mark still running in the 6th spot. You've got Earnhardt closing in right behind. Terry Labonte certainly has finished 6th here last year. He's had, 18 top 10s this year in 24 events. So, I mean, 3/4 of the field would like to have that kind of consistency. It's not what Terry, though, is particularly used to as far as not getting to victory lane.
It'll buy a new door.
Yeah, but he's had days like today as well, Eli. That team has absolutely struggled since they unloaded that car off the trailer. They haven't been able to pinpoint anything and say this is exactly what's wrong with the car. It's just been slow. They have not been able to fix it. It's the oldest car they have in the stable, and this morning they arrived at the conclusion they really shouldn't have brought that car. They maybe should have brought something else instead.
Of course, 5th in points overall for Terry Labonte. There's Bobby Hamilton, the race leader. He's going to put the 33rd place machine a lap down. The 18th, sir. Lap number 67, the only caution of the day as Jeff Gordon tags Jeff Bodine, who goes around. One lap later under caution, the ailing Jeff Burton is replaced by Todd Bodine. And at lap 81, Bobby Hamilton takes the lead for the third time in the CMT 300. There are some of the fellows who are looking for wins here today. Somewhere, anywhere. It's been a while for some of those fellows. Brett Bodine, Bill Elliott, Bobby Hamilton. On down the line, Lake Speed, not since 1988 in Darlington. Matt, some pretty big names on that list.
And one of the big names on that list, Bill Elliott. Every week they've been getting closer and closer. Mike Dean says each week if we can just keep that momentum rolling, victory lane. Today, they are tad tight. They were loose before the last pit stop. They went a little too far, and now the car has gone to the tight side. He's going to ride it out. Gurley's still holding in the top 10. They will ride it out until the next caution, or their pit stop window opens up.
See Bobby Hamilton skating around just a bit there. Let's watch him again, particularly off turn 4. Watch the rear try and pick out just a bit on Bobby Hamilton.
Eli, this part of the run, nobody's just riding around out there. All the cars are beginning to skate just a little bit. Him maybe just a little less than the rest.
You don't want the car to push here at New Hampshire. You want the car to be, if anything, a little bit on the loose side. You'd love to have it neutral, but that's almost impossible. The drivers will push the cars to the point of breaking either the nose loose or the tail end loose. It looks as if Hamilton, everybody, having a little problem with the tail end.
Well, yeah, I think everybody, the tires are beginning to get hot, they're getting worn, and everybody's slipping a little bit. You see John Andretti running third there. Ernie Irvin is really on a mission. He's comes from 40th to 4th right now, and he'll take over third pretty quick. He's running down from full straightaway in just a few laps here.
And now for rundown on top of the screen, but Steve, I think Buddy's pretty well hit on what's going on right now.
Exactly. We just listened to Ricky Craven and Andy Graves talking back and forth, and we hear the phrase tire management, but that's exactly what Craven has to do. He says, when I run this car hard, I really start to get loose, and Andy's coaxing him just to calm down and run the car at an even pace.
So we'll see whether that works for Ricky Craven right there, the number 25, who's led here today as early as lap number 4. No, interesting, did you realize that last week at Richmond, first time all year, that not a single one of the Hendrick cars led a lap? Not Jeff Gordon, not Terry Labonte, not Ricky Craven. First time all year, none of the Hendrick cars led even one lap at Richmond.
I bet this guy's going to listen to his preaching really well. Ricky Craven does not like a loose race car. If anything, he likes to have it even tighter than some of the other guys. And he does, oh boy, look at this. Look at this.
They've got Robert Presley in the 77. Remember, he took over from Morgan Shepherd earlier in the week there in number 77, a one-race deal with the Busch Series off this weekend. You saw the moves there, and you see Bill Elliott making the move around Rick Mast. Rick Mast has won here in the past in the NASCAR Busch Series. Matter of fact, the last of his 9 wins in his Busch Series career was here back in 1990. And you know, we talked about guys starting in the back and winning. Even that day in the Busch Series, Rick Mast started 18th and came on to win the race. So starting in the position hasn't always been the key to victory lane here. Let's watch Ole Ernie.
Ernie, a very good dirt race car driver, and believe you me, right now he's dirt tracking that car just a little bit. It's not a walk in the park for him. You can see him really working the wheel as he starts off the corner. I was watching him in turn 2 just a second ago as he started off. The back kicked out. He never cracked the throttle. He just lifted the left rear up and went on.
You don't have to worry about him cracking the throttle either. That guy is on the gas.
Dirt tracked it all the way to third spot in that move. 127 laps down, 173 as you see on the screen remaining. Only one caution period thus far for the spin involving Jeff Bodine. Nobody's gone to the garage area. Each and every one of the 43 starters still out on the racetrack. Bobby Hamilton took the lead most recently at lap number 81. He can't shake Ricky Craven, but he's not giving up the top spot either. Glad you're with us. We're coming right back. Ricky Craven in his 85th career NASCAR Winston Cup start. He is just blown right by Bobby Hamilton. Here's how it happened a half lap ago.
Almost made it look easy. Hamilton drifting up just a little bit. Ricky Craven on the bottom. Boom, he's your leader again.
You know, it's almost on the stopwatch, Buddy, as though Ricky was just kind of riding around at a set pace. And then when Ernie Irvin started turning up the wick a bit and moving up, it seems like Ricky started to get going.
Well, now the true test comes. They're all on very old tires. They're low on fuel. Now the great balance in race cars shows up. Ricky Craven looked in the mirror, said 28 is coming like a whirlwind. I better go.
The other test is they've got a lot of traffic to drive through as well. All the cars that started this race are still out here.
Glenn, what's your stopwatch saying?
Well, Eli, here's the big stopwatch. We're looking at Jeff Gordon. They've got a computer here clocking every car, every lap. You can see Craven at 31.29. You get back down here to Jeff Gordon, 30.59. He is over almost 3/4 of a second quicker. This is what happens when you get on old tires. You can look up and down the list here. This is what the guys are doing on old tires. The cars that have consistently been quicker have been Jeff Gordon, Ted Musgrave, and Dale Jarrett have been turning the best lap times. But Ricky Craven and Ernie Irvin have really turned up the wick in the last few laps. So interesting to watch and see what they do on those old tires. That's when the difference really starts to be big.
And we should point out that all of that information is available as you see Jeff Gordon make the move now, and you saw Ernie moments ago get around Bobby Hamilton. All of that computer information is available to every team up and down pit road. It's not something that just one or two guys have. It's all based on the little transponders, little computer chips that ride on every race car. That's how the scoring is done. And there you see Bobby Hamilton twice now in the last lap about losing it. But that's where all of that information that Glenn was showing you comes from. Matt, what's going on with the 43?
Eli, the car is just a tad loose. As Glenn said, the course of this run, they wanted to pit around lap 145.
upper right-hand corner of your screen. They're at lap 135 now, so just 10 laps away if they can get that far, but they're losing a lot of distance.
Yeah, they are. They've gone from first to seventh in almost a heartbeat, Eli.
Yeah, watch it again here. He had problems really at both ends of the speedway.
Watch him. He's on a good line right there. Watch the back of the car right here. Just kick out. He tries to get it back. You see it kick out again. He's probably thinking right now, do I have a flat tire? And then he kind of feels it out and realizes the car just got very, very loose there.
Really losing spots. Boom, boom, boom.
So he is back to seventh. At this point, 5.5 seconds behind the race leader, Ricky Craven. And look who's closing in on Ricky now. Ernie Irvin, our winner here a year ago.
If you want to see what's good about the 28, watch it from the center of the corner to the straightaway. They're about even getting in the corner, but right about this area, he really comes on like a rocket ship.
And of course, the key to New Hampshire is being the first guy to get back on the gas exiting the corner. You can get slowed down really without using a whole heck of a lot of brake here and still get on the gas quickly. You can do all that. You ought to be the guy to beat.
Tell you what, Ricky Craven's not going to be a pushover. He's got a pretty good race car. It looks like he looks up every once in a while just to see where he's at. But what a great run for Ricky Craven.
Still no pit stops for Bobby Hamilton. Kenny Schrader is stopping, though. He'll open up this pit sequence at lap 138. Matt, what are you hearing from Robbie Loomis and from the King?
Eli, the 43 car has picked up a vibration. If Bobby Hamilton can hold on to it for about another 7 laps, they will pit at lap 145. When it gets worse, he will come in sooner. Kenny Schrader out there road, taking 1.5 rounds of wedge out of the right rear. It is a four-tire stop. He was complaining the car was loose. Kenny Schrader's in his service out there road. The right side's down, the left side's going on, making an adjustment to the left side, and he's out of the way.
Boy, I tell you one thing, Glenn, you hit it right on the head a while ago about Jeff Gordon. He's moved into third, and he is just behind these guys. You'll see the nose of that car coming. He has really turned it up here. He's moving to the front.
97-point lead atop the NASCAR Winston Cup Series point standings with Jeff Gordon over Mark Martin. Dale Jarrett is third in points, 153 down. And Jeff Burton, fourth in points, 268 in arrears. Well, pit stops are about 5 laps away. We're going to break away quickly. We'll come back for the service. Robert Yates getting set to see if Ernie can grab the lead.
There's no...
ahead of Jeff Gordon now and Ernie Irvin. Hey, NASCAR Thunder, the official store of NASCAR, now opening new locations all across the country. Get online at www.country.com and get all the information about the official stores of NASCAR. NASCAR Thunder. Now, there you see the running order. Watch what's happened on the racetrack over the last few moments. Watch Robbie Gordon just ahead of Ricky Craven.
Woo-hoo!
Yahoo! That was close, right in front of the leaders. Gordon's having a devil of a time, Craven's having a devil of a time with Gordon. Can't get really by him.
Now let's see what happens here. Jeff Gordon in second, Ernie Irvin third. They have not made stops, only Schrader. You've not missed anything on pit road. Here comes Wally Dahlen back. He'll come in as the next team to make a stop. Wally's in 38th, a couple of laps down, but none of the leaders have stopped yet.
Drivers in first and second have been pals for a long, long time. Gordon helped Craven along to get his DuPont sponsorship when he was running that in Grand National Racing. I bet they aren't too friendly right about now, though.
You can see the three cars are very evenly matched, but look at Gordon get the good forward bite off the corner. Now, Craven will probably, he was able to hold him off, but it's just a matter of time right now. Gordon's looking inside and outside, and as soon as Craven just makes one little move, he's going to get by him.
Here comes Bobby Hamilton. He'll pit, and so does Rusty, but here goes Jeff Gordon for the lead. This is at lap 148. Give it to him. Jeff Gordon takes over at lap 148. Meanwhile, Bobby Hamilton is on the pit lane.
This will be a four-tire pit stop for the STP Pontiac of Bobby Hamilton. He had a vibration. He wasn't exactly sure where it was, so they are going to change four tires and fuel. The right sides are already on. Great teamwork by the STP bunch, and he has got it away.
Kyle Petty is coming. in for service now at lap number 149. Also making a pit stop is Hunt Strickland. All of this is under green.
Coming up through here also. He's got a really fast car. You see him right there in the pit going into the corner. He's trying to nerve it and raise it down. So he's right in the middle of the battle.
Glenn, what are you hearing?
Yes, sir. From Brian Vanderkirk, Ernie's PR guy, and Ernie radioed in and told the guys in the crew to tell the 25 spotter that if he does that to me again, I'm going to punt him. So, he didn't like that little move of Craven cutting him down there. Ernie should be in. They're planning on coming in on lap 155.
We're now at 150. Brett Bodine is stopping. John Andretti is stopping. Sterling Marlin makes a pit stop. Others are coming in as well. Gary Bradbury is in at lap 150. Ooh, again, he skated off the corner. First due for a pit stop here. The car just not quite getting the set that it was earlier. Now more and more of the leaders are coming down the pit lane. You see at the bottom of the screen, lap 151 as Jeff Gordon leads. 20th race he has led this year. Matt Yoakum now down in the Andretti pit.
John Andretti here. He wins the four-tire pit stop for the 98 car. He tells us to make sure you clean the windshield well. It is extremely dirty. A lot of drivers complaining about windshields being dirty. Great service for him. They're almost done. Let's go back upstairs.
We ride with Jeff Gordon. Other leaders in now. Derek Cope making his stop. Ward Burton has been in. Kenny Wallace in. Chad Little on the pit lane as well. This is the fifth race at New Hampshire that Jeff Gordon has led. He didn't lead here in July, but this is the fifth of six events and he's led at this beautiful racetrack.
If you're watching really carefully just a few moments ago, you saw John Andretti's bunch have trouble at the back end of the car with the rear tires. They have a new rear tire changer, a new rear tire carrier. They do great at the shop, but they are having problems at the racetrack, and that one cost them because it was on the green flag.
All of these stops under green as Jeff Gordon continues to lead. He was in at lap 68. Here's Ernie Irvin for a stop, Glenn.
Yep, he's in one lap early, and it will be a four-tire change. I can see the right front. It still looks pretty good, although it's worn pretty badly. Already around to the left rear is Raymond Fox. Man, he's fast. Jack just now getting around here. Ernie radioed in and told him, do not make any changes on this car. I like the way it is. So it's four tires of fuel. He's gone in 19.5 seconds. Great pit stop for the guys.
Dale Jarrett has been in. Darrell Waltrip, Dave Marcus. Here comes Dick Trickle for service. This now at lap 155. Steve Burns is waiting for Ricky Craven to come in.
And a few laps ago, Eli, we saw Jeff Gordon go past him. Andy Graves says, hang on, we'll get you fixed up. They're making a chassis adjustment to the left rear.
For service, Terry Labonte is in. Todd Bodine is in, subbing for Jeff Burton. Others making their stops are David Green, Bill Elliott. Steve Grissom is in for service. Glenn, what are you hearing?
I just wanted to update you on Todd Bodine, Eli. You remarked that he was in the pits, and he was. Buddy Perry told Todd not to worry. They had something up their sleeve. What was it? They only changed right side tires. He was in and out of here in a little less than 15 seconds. So about 14 seconds. Leads in the game 5 to 6 seconds on the racetrack on the other guys. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Jeff Bodine. Jeff Gordon slowly going down. He goes 45 miles per hour. He hits his mark. Mike Trower and the Rainbow Warriors going to work. This will be a four-tire pit stop. Jeff is telling Ray Everdam, the car is a tad tight. Just loosen it up a hair. And you see him go around to the left side of the car. Good pit work by the Rainbow Warriors.
New leader, Mark Martin, but he comes off the pit road, or on the pit road for service. That'll give Rick Mast the lead now at lap number 158. Rick Mast is the leader. Matt Yoakum is watching Mark Martin stop.
The leader hits pit road. Mark Martin already in his pit 6 seconds, 7 seconds. You see him make a chassis adjustment on the right side of the car. They go around to the left side. Good work by the Valvoline crew. Mark Martin had a good run going here last time. They definitely need a good run today.
right there. Rick Mast comes off the racetrack, so he will hand the lead off. And it will circle around to Jimmy Spencer now, who has not yet made his stop. There you see Bobby Hamilton on the racetrack with Earnhardt. They are 10th and 11th right now as they work up into turn number three. But again, Jimmy Spencer at this very moment is the race leader, having not stopped during this sequence. All of this happening in the green. Here comes Spencer now as he peels off the limited banking of turn four. So Jimmy is in at lap number 160. Travis Carter's bunch going to work. And that cycles things around to Jeff Gordon, who is again the race leader.
Nice donut on the door there, don't they?
Yeah. Now let's see here on the stopwatch how Jeff Gordon is doing. He has the lead over Ernie Irvin. When he came on the pit road, his lead was 3 seconds. It is now 4.6 seconds. So in the exchange of pit stops, the deceleration, the change, and then the acceleration, he picked up 1 6/10 seconds over the second place man.
And when they wonder why Jeff Gordon does so well, you just look at any area of his program, whether it's engines or suspension or that pit crew or the way they do their pit stops or aerodynamics, it is all together, it is all there. And Gordon, once again, is leading a Winston Cup race as a consequence.
It is Gordon ahead of Irvin second, Martin third. Craven is fourth, Hamilton is fifth. And both Jeffs, as we told you on the pre-race segment, coming to play. Jeff Burton out, Gordon the leader. We're keeping you up to speed on who's running where. Jeff Bodine was running well, then he spins there in 13th position. No caution. He did the 360 and continued away. Remember, he had that spin in traffic as he and Jeff Gordon tangled back at lap 68. This one here at lap 167. And we stay under the green. I was about to say, hopefully we're keeping you up to speed on the scoring, but if you want some additional assistance, remember, NASCAR Online is available at that computer address, www.nascar.com. David Hyatt and his whole staff on hand here. They've got scoring up to the moment and all sorts of special features. NASCAR Online, your 24-hour NASCAR Garage Pass. Well, Jeff Bodine gets back in line in 20th. Here's what happened. Came off the corner and round she goes.
Well, there are a lot of changes in that team to try to turn things around, but that's not what they meant when they said turn things around.
I would think not.
No.
There he is in 20th spot, Jeff, just ahead of Bobby Labonte and right behind Terry Labonte. Back up front, the race leader is Jeff Gordon. There you see him putting, or at least trying to put, Kenny Wallace and Michael Waltz at the lap down. There you see how pit stops shook down. 1 6/10 seconds, though, was the sum of all of what you saw there. That's the edge that Jeff Gordon picked up. He's now better than 4 seconds ahead. Actually, better than 5 seconds ahead now. 5.4 seconds is Gordon's lead on Ernie Irvin.
It's going to be a disconcerting sight to see that in the fellow's rearview mirror, to see that red, white, and yellow and blue car coming up.
And watching, and there goes Jeremy Mayfield. He'll move around sixth place Dale Earnhardt. So Mayfield, of course, he appeared headed for a fifth place finish at Richmond until that tire started going flat with six laps to go. Still finished in 10th, and he's using that same car here. This is the same car he had at Richmond. Steve, he's having an awfully good run. He's really developed over the last year and a half or so.
Yeah, and he's never had a particularly strong finish here at New Hampshire, but Paul Andrews telling Jeremy the Mayfield the same thing Andy Graves telling his driver Ricky Craven, just take it easy on the tires, be patient. The young guys, a little more difficult when they have a good horse to ride, but again, Jeremy Mayfield just trying to be patient. Go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, down here at this end of pit road, which is the far end coming off of turn four, you see something you don't very see in that, very often see in NASCAR racing. The 77 car driven by Robert Presley today. Look what they're having to pit, man, back here in in the alley. They didn't leave Port Robert much room to come in. What happened here? There's only 42 pit spaces. Terry Labonte had to use a champion's provisional to get in the field. That put 43 cars in the field. If you look over here, you'll see some of the federal mogul Jasper guys interspersed with the Kodak guys. They're having to share this pit space. So far, it hadn't been a problem. The four car has pitted long before the 77 car. So a little bit of an unusual situation. They're just a little bit out of room down here.
And regretfully, neither of those teams doing particularly well today. Sterling is running in 38 and Robert Presley in 42nd.
You can see Kenny Wallace, even though he's not up in the front right now, he's running very well. Jeff Gordon's been behind him some 3-4 laps right now. Kenny's running very, very well, but he just has bad track position. And Gordon, they're leading the race, so not get back.
There's Kenny Wallace in 27th, Waltzip in 26th, trying as best they can to stay on the lead lap.
Maybe their most important defensive maneuver of the whole day. Stay on the lead lap. Hope there's a caution flag before you get eaten alive here.
Or you want to try to Yeah. Let's see what Jeff Gordon's doing. Is looking for a different way to enter the corner.
He found it, didn't he?
Yep. That's Kenny Wallace, the square D car with whom we're riding.
That looks like Jaws 3 there. That big guy right up in that camera just then.
Is good here. Don't forget, he won here in Grand National Racing in 1991 as Gordon gets by on the inside now. One of his better racetracks.
So Jeff Gordon now putting the 27th place runner a lap down. Michael Waltzip just ahead in the Citgo number 21.
They're charting who's going where next year. Phil Martosi said that Kenny Wallace will be back with him again next year despite all the stories to the contrary, and the sponsor is returning. And Phil has promised he will return as well.
I know one thing, that tachometer was a little scary right there. That was 9,000 down the front straightaway there.
It was wound as tight as she's going to go. Just ahead of the race leader, you've got Brett Bodine, who is already a lap down in 36. And you got Michael Waltzip. He's going to try and stay on the lead lap there, Matt, if he can do it.
He's trying, Eli. He's actually turned the last lap faster than the leader. The problem with Michael Waltzip, his car was a little loose the last run. A pit stop that came in, added some wedge, he's gone back out. He really needs the caution because he wants to get back in line because he's about to go a lap down.
Sixth spot, Hamilton back to seventh.
You know, I was watching Earnhardt as they started this run. When he come back on the racetrack, that car was so tight it wouldn't turn going in the corner. But as he goes along, Earnhardt gets faster and faster as the racetrack comes to him. He's one of the fastest players right near the pit stop.
But it is Jeff Gordon who continues to show the way. Interestingly, he and Jeremy Mayfield, who's now fifth, the only active drivers under the age of 28, who have won more than $2 million in their NASCAR Winston Cup career. Sponsored in part by Featherlite Trailers, the official trailers of NASCAR, CART, the IRL, and major sponsor of the NHRA. Remember to call Featherlite for all your trailer needs at 800-800-1230 or 319-547-6000. Commercial transportation for this broadcast has been provided by Ryder, the official transportation company of Opryland. We are live at New Hampshire International Speedway, the CMT 300. There's Johnny Benson in the number 30 Pennzoil machine. And take a look what happened to him just a few moments ago. He's with Bobby Labonte there. Watch this.
We made a little contact the second time again. You see Bobby getting under control, but Benson, what a great job of catching that car and straightening it back up.
He really did. He did a lot of racing on dirt early in his career, and he brought all that into play right at that moment.
And Hutch Kicklin was right in there also.
Yeah. Johnny Benson running in the 23rd spot now after all of that. In case you've not heard, Johnny Benson is leaving Bahari Racing after the season. We talked to him and to the owner of the number 30 car, Chuck Ryder.
It was hard. It was an extremely hard decision. All these guys on the team have done a tremendous job, and, you know, we've had an okay year, but it's just, I don't know, just different circumstances, I guess, and we're just going to go our different ways, and, you know, I wish the best for Chuck, and he does for me, so I just think it's going to be a good situation for myself next year with Roush Racing, and hopefully we're just going to see what happens in the future.
He's been a great representative for us, both on the track and off. He has just a tremendous amount of skill, and he's going to do extremely well in this series. We wish him great future, but Bahari will go on. We have some great people in Doug Hewitt, Ron Currier, Dane Perrottoni, all the people back in Mooresville at our shop. What a great staff, and we're looking forward to 1998 with our new driver.
And again, as was reported earlier, indications are that Derek Cope will likely be in that car next year, though official word is not expected until the middle of the week. Johnny Benson going to Roush Racing to be part of a fifth operation, a fifth car, to go along with three NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series teams, because Roush Racing has also hired Greg Biffle from the NASCAR Rebco Northwest Tour to join Joe Ruttman and Chuck Bound. We're at lap 190, just 110 laps from the finish. There's the other Roush team, the number 99 there, the Exide Batteries Ford. Jeff Burton started the day. You know the story. Bothered by inner ear problems. Todd Bodine has taken over, and he's worked his way up through the field nicely, Glenn.
Yeah, he has, Eli. He's up to 18th there. He got as high as 16th, but a couple of cars with fresher rubber than he has have passed him on the racetrack. Remember, they only took on two tires. Jeff Burton is sitting up on top of the War Wagon number two. He's been kind of directing things, listening to what's been going on. Everybody down here right now very pleased with what Todd is doing. As he told us earlier this morning, Eli, he's got to do the best he can without jeopardizing the car. He can't take any chances, so he's just out there, I think, doing a very, very incredible job right now.
And it's been quite a struggle to get that credible job done. When he first tried to drive the car, it was set up for Burton, who likes the car very, very loose, and Bodine just couldn't hang on to it. He said there was no traction at the back end. He didn't like it at all. They worked on it, and finally they got it to his liking. And doing a terrific job here, passing cars, staying out of trouble, doing exactly what he had to do.
Texaco Haviland 3 bringing you the points as they run at this very second. Our first retiree of the day has just gone to the garage area as Jeff Green has just taken the Cartoon Network machine to the garage area. There you see Jeff Gordon, the race leader, right there working around the speedway. Dale Earnhardt's been having a fairly good run. He is now in sixth there in the three, just ahead of Bobby Hamilton. And you know what, this being the CMT 300 and Country Music Television brings you all the videos that you want to see. How about Dale Earnhardt and Brooks and Dunn as they shot this in Las Vegas?
They made it fun. You think about going and you get a little tense, nervous, and thinking about trying to be in front of the camera and look like you know what you're doing or doing what you're supposed to be doing. And they made it fun. The producers and everybody that worked on it, the director, it was a lot of fun. I got to hand it to them. It came out a lot nicer than I thought it would. Jeff Gordon already in his box getting serviced by the Rainbow Warriors. It's a four-tire pit stop. Jeff said the car was still a little tad tight. They were loosening him up with air pressure. He's down and away. He almost got held up on the 18, but he is out. But Ricky Craven beats him off the road.
So the pit stop's taking place at lap number 198. Robert Presley has already gotten out of the car without any problem. There you see the cleanup taking place. He went into turn number three, and we were eavesdropping on the radio. He said something just broke, and around he went into the wall. But again, Robert was quickly to get out of the car and seemed to be just fine. knocked down to the pits, Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, right before that happened, Robert had been in the pits under green for about 20 laps, and they were working up under the left front suspension area. They were actually working around the tie rod end area and the left front shock absorber. So evidently, they may not have gotten something just exactly back the way that it should have been, because I have a suspicion that's exactly what broke on the car.
And there you see Kenny Wallace as he makes his stop. He is going to be held by the NASCAR officials. And we'll get an update from the pit lane in just a moment or so. But Kenny Wallace came in for his pit stop. And you see the NASCAR, in this instance, a Busch Series uniformed official there. Now with the Winston Cup official alongside, they are going to hold Kenny Wallace on the pit lane. The reason we're under the caution is that right there, Robert Presley. Here's what happened. Tail end of the accident. He just went up into the corner and looped her right around.
Do you think that's a team that could use a break or what? They're on their third driver. They had three crew chiefs there. They had trouble making races, and now, boom, into the wall they go in New Hampshire. They do need a break.
There's Jeremy Mayfield in sixth. Steve Burns with an update.
Eli, they thought about making a track bar adjustment, but as we said a little while ago, they are running so well, they made no adjustments, just bolted on four new Goodyears, so no adjustments for Jeremy Mayfield. They're very confident with the way the car is running and the way Jeremy Mayfield is holding that steering wheel.
So that's the report on Jeremy Mayfield. Figuring out exactly what happened there with Kenny Wallace, we are told now by the NASCAR officials that he had passed the pace car out on the racetrack, which in its own right is illegal. He was then told to stop on the racetrack and get back in the position that he rightfully held, and did not do so. So the two laps that he gained on everybody right there, and the penalty being assessed on the pit road. We are at lap 201. Hey, there's the CNN Motorsports trailer in the midway. Beautiful countryside around the New Hampshire International Speedway, Laconia to the north and Concord and Manchester to the south. That camera shot brought to you by DuraShine Advanced Auto Polish. Just wipe it on and hose it off. DuraShine, available at Pet Boys, Western Auto, Kmart, and Target stores.
Another one of the guys I ask for advice when I'm in the garage area, especially about what I'm going to do with my people and about where we're headed. I go and see Mike Bean. Is there anything special that you're going to try and do this year to maybe help keep the guys from getting burned out a little bit, get them some time off, or put more people on?
Well, what we do, we've added some people, but, you know, like the people that goes on the road, you know, usually they have Tuesdays off. They come in on Monday, we get all our notes and, you know, have our team meeting, discuss what happened, how we need to get better, and, you know, then Tuesday they have time to, you know, take care of the personal business.
Well, when crew chiefs chat, they don't always talk about the race car. And one of the guys that I go and see about business or about helping us through these long hours is Mike Bean.
And that was brought to you by Peerless Faucets, the do-it-for-yourself faucet. Green flag is in the air. We're back to racing now at lap 204.
That almost looked like Pocono, didn't it? They spread wide here on the...
Skinner hangs on, the 37 there. Mayfield came through, and Skinner goes wide in the corner. You see him right up against the wall. Boy, if that had gone around, that would have stacked up half the field.
Mike Skinner had the problem. You see him waving there to let everybody know he's off speed there and let them get by him.
He's staying wide. You see everybody going by, and now Bobby Labonte, last in line, goes by, and Skinner's coming down the pit lane. He'll stop here at lap 207. Too bad for Mike Skinner. Had himself a decent run going. What's going on, Glenn? What are you hearing?
He came by me, a lot of smoke in the right front stand. Looks like the right front tire is definitely flat. He cut it when he got up against the wall, up in that debris.
Meanwhile, looks like Craven, the leader, went wide. You see that? That's all it took, a half a car length, and bam, they went right by him.
At least Gordon did.
Yeah.
Mark Martin would like to have gotten by him. Couldn't quite close in before the 25 got back down in that low lane, the preferred way around this racetrack.
So Gordon now the leader. Craven led most recently from 200 to 206. And lap 207, Jeff Gordon takes over and begins to pull away.
They had a great modified race here at this Speedway yesterday.
Oh, what's it called?
I'll tell you what, folks. If you can't get tickets for Sunday's Winston Cup race, come and watch the modifieds here at least once in your life. It is an absolutely spectacular show.
Reggie Ruggiero from 37th spot.
Yeah, provisional.
Yep, came on to win the event yesterday. Ted Christopher winning the NASCAR Busch North Series race. He had a super run.
Another good race. Yeah. Real good race.
That was a super good shot from inside of Mark Martin's car. You could see how fast he goes down that back straightaway. Good race here with Earnhardt, Bobby Hamilton.
That's 7th and 8th spot, those two.
You know what? Earnhardt has been in the thick of this thing all day long, and that has changed from a lot of the races he has run this year. He has run toward the front today, and that's what he has needed to do all year long. It's coming back together, at least here today.
He said there this morning, talking, that realistically here in July, when he finished second, realistically, we had a fourth and fifth place race car, got a couple of breaks and finished second. So they're right in that general area again. Of course, Dale Jarrett right there in the mix now in the 88 car.
I was just fixing to say, Dale Jarrett has made very little noise today, but he's been consistent, very fast, and he's right up there. He's in six.
He has had eight top five. Whoa, and look at that.
Well, that's the Earnhardt of all, isn't it?
He's feeling fine.
Yeah, remember July, the 88 and 28, Jarrett and Irvin up front all day long until they both had engine problems. They found out what was wrong. They got that thing all fixed. The engines are just fine now. Those guys can get around this racetrack as well as anybody.
We're at lap 211. We've only been slowed a couple of times by caution. That ties the record we had here in July, only two cautions. Remember back in 1994, 17 caution periods. Only two here in July, only two thus far today, with 89 laps now remaining. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Well, Eli, watching at home today is CNN's newest racing viewer, Mary Kendall McReynolds. Take a look at that. Last Saturday, look at that, his second daughter, and of course his son Brandon's next nightmare. Now he's got two sisters to worry about, the boy, beautiful little daughter.
And Larry's as proud as could be today. We're talking in the garage area, same thing last week in Richmond. So very, very happy for the entire McReynolds family. Back up front, Jeff Gordon still showing the way, Ricky Craven is second. Irvin, Martin, and Mayfield. That's your top five. We're coming right back. CMT 300 is live here at New Hampshire International Speedway, a magnificent day. We're about 2 weeks early for the colors to start changing on all those trees, fall foliage time, about 2 weeks away, but you do want a nicer day than we've had today, and that's what Jeff Gordon is saying, I'm sure, right now. You see Ernie Irvin now in second. He has gotten around Ricky Craven to grab the spot. Now let's start thinking another thing here, too. You see this move by Ernie Irvin. You know he's strong, has been all day. The question is, though, as we watch him make the move for second, is he going to have fuel enough now to go to the finish? Who is and who isn't? Because with the pit stops that were at lap 198, 199, and 200, Glenn, how many guys can go, do you think, or are they all going to have to stop?
Checking with the guys in the lead lap right now, and so far, Ernie Irvin, Mark Reno told me they could not. Robin Pemberton with Rusty Wallace says they could not. Check this list of those who can. Ricky Rudd, Terry Labonte, Dale Earnhardt, and Jimmy Spencer. Those are all the guys that are that have been challenging up in the top 15 or so that are down at my end. We'll get a report from the other guys down there in just a minute, but this could be interesting if it goes green the rest of the way.
Matt, we also saw guys like Johnny Benson and Bobby Labonte come in and top off.
Bobby Labonte came in and topped off, as did Johnny Benson. A note on the leader, by their calculations, they may come up six laps short. So they are working that calculator feverishly. Now here in the Lowe's pit, they had the tire from the Lowe's Chevrolet. The cut down, they totally shredded the tire. It was a cut down tire. The Goodyear engineers are looking at it. He just ran over some kind of debris, cut it down. But I think he's driving today thanks to a guy up in the booth. Buddy, I think he spent quite a bit of time. The in that inner liner, did you not?
Yeah. I said, you want me to run over what and how fast?
A lot of guys contributed. The late Darrell Harrington did some of that. Here's a big move for the lead. Give it to Ernie Irvin. Ernie, and that brings the fans to their feet here. The Ernie Irvin contingent loved what they just saw at lap number 222.
And there's a big Ernie Irvin contingent here at New Hampshire. He has always been exciting here. Remember in 94, he won the pole for this thing, won the race in 1996, led 42 laps here in July. Ernie is good anywhere, but he is especially good here in New Hampshire, and they love him.
This is the fourth race he has led of the five that he has been in. Remember, he missed one here. There's a good battle there, fourth and fifth spot. Jeremy Mayfield, he has been strong all day, Steve.
Yeah, you know, I just checked in their pits, and they cannot make it on fuel mileage. They will have to make another gas bomb.
So that's something to follow up there for Jeremy Mayfield. But maybe Ernie's the biggest story of the day. Gets in on a provisional starting spot. And here, I mean, he's gone from the outhouse to the penthouse.
From 40th to the lead. I mean, he didn't look into this. He raced his way past every car in the field. So Ernie is doing a great job. I know he would love to end this ride with a winning note here. He's going to do everything. I talked to him yesterday. He said, I'm going to do everything I can to win every race at the end of the year.
Only three top five finishes this year. He won at Michigan, you remember. He was second in Atlanta and fourth in the other race in Michigan. He also failed to finish eight events. And that's the kind of up and down season that that Texaco Haviland team.
Oh,
around goes Hut Strickland. Turn number two, Hut Strickland goes around.
Watch out.
There he is. They're coming around. Hut was running in 13th. And we're under caution.
Yeah, there went some of the strategy and the worry about fuel mileage.
Hut Strickland spins.
They'll all have enough gas now to go all the way.
Oh, yeah. And it was good to speculate about it while we have the opportunity. David Green has just taken the Caterpillar car behind the wall. He had come down pit road a short while ago with what looked to be maybe a brake problem. A lot of smoke billowing from the wheel well areas.
And an inability to stop where he wanted to.
That's a giveaway right there.
He just got rolling right by that break in the wall and could not bring the thing to a halt.
So caution for the third time today, lap 226 of 300.
Look at that crowd. Look at those people.
Wow. Look coming down pit road. It's like feeding time at the zoo to me.
Everybody stands. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Relay, Ernie brings the Texaco Haviland Ford in. This will be a two-tire change only. No changes. He is down and away. I got the stopwatch on him. Wow. 9.96 seconds. Here's Steve.
Similar pit strategies there at lap number 227. So we're under caution for this incident. The Circuit City machine all on his lonesome. Then comes low.
Whoa, Michael Waltrip gets in the left rear corner there and turns him around.
Hutt was working his way back to the low groove, and that's where Michael already was. So caution. We're at lap 227.
Green flag.
You heard the call. Green. Green flag is out, and we are back to racing here in New Hampshire. 70 laps to go. The leader is the 24, Jeff Gordon. Ted Musgrave is now second in the 16. The red car just ahead of the leaders. Late team, he is on the tail end of the lead lap, running in 26th position. Out of the event, Jeff Green, Robert Presley, and David Green. Everybody else still on the speedway as we wrapped up the third caution of the day. Saw that battle for the lead, but Musgrave just couldn't get a good grip to the racetrack off the corner.
Well, he's looking there, and Craven is doing everything he can to get under him, and he's doing a little defensive driving also there. You can see Craven right on his back bumper.
Now remember, Musgrave came onto the pit lane in eighth place and came out in second. Bill Elliott take any tires. He came in 10th. He went back out in 4th. And maybe Steve Grissom made the biggest jump.
Steve Grissom came in 41st place and went out in 6th. So what a great pit stop those guys had.
Conversely, Jeremy Mayfield went from 5th to 16th.
Man, you could just about hear the metal popping. They were three wide down the front straightaway. Somebody had to give. There's a lot of cars out of position right now up high in turn two.
22 Ward Burton way up there against the fence. And this kind of stuff has been going on. Oh, look at Schrader in there in the middle. This will not continue. This just can't continue. Either somebody's going to crash or they're going to get in line. One or the other.
Schrader is in 39th. He is many laps down. He is 6 laps down now in the 33.
He keeps getting caught on those yellow flags. It seems all we need to have happen to get a yellow flag here in New Hampshire is for Schrader to take a regularly scheduled pit stop, and sooner or later, boom, there comes the yellow flag, and he has really been hurt by it.
That's Todd Bodine we're riding with. He's in for Jeff Burton, who's bothered by the inner ear problem. They made the driver change at lap number 68. Oh, and there go Bodine and Ricky Rudd.
Three wide?
You called it. You called it.
Caution is out. Caution should be out. They're behind. Cover in 3.
Bodine and Rudd, you got a glimpse of it from the in-car picture that we had there for you at the time. And then round they went. Poor old Ricky Rudd. Ricky's got a bit of a fire beneath the right front. They were running 24th and 25th. Let's see if Michael Waltrip there in the 21 can get a lap back. No, he won't be able to. Misses by about 100 yards or so. And Ricky's okay. The a little smoke we saw there from some problem extinguished itself. Ricky's day is done. Lake Speed got his lap back, and look at that.
See Jeff Bodine underneath there. They made contact getting into turn 3. There goes around Rudd. Look how close Rusty Wallace gets in the 2 car to getting into Bodine there.
Rusty did a real nice job. Didn't even scratch the fender.
Ricky Rudd, who loves this racetrack. Watch it again.
Wide.
You can see Bodine's car there. It was right down on the yellow line when they made contact. That happens in close racing. That's not on purpose by either driver. You can believe that.
We'll take another look at it here.
It almost worked. Bobby Labonte got into line nicely.
Look at Todd Bodine in the 99 there, just getting by on the inside also.
Rusty gets by. Andretti, Rick Mast, all getting by to the inside. But we're under caution for the 4th time for that spin up in turns 3 and 4. The Tide Bunch, they'll look things over, but they won't like what they see. Now there's Ricky Rudd. He's out of the car and walking back. And that was one of the cars that they built themselves, as opposed to the usual Laughlin or Hopkins car. It's one that they built and tested a couple of weeks ago at the Greenville Pick'em Speedway in South Carolina. While we're under caution, time for our Tech Fact, brought to you by the more than 1,725 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts.
On nearly every Winston Cup pit stop that's made, we hear crew chiefs, tire guys talking about tire pressure adjustments, as little as a half pound, sometimes even a quarter of a pound. Steve Mill, the general manager at Roush Racing, is going to tell us exactly what those minute adjustments do. Steve, how can a 1 pound or even a quarter pound adjustment make a difference?
Well, the 1 pound or quarter pound adjustment attests to how tough the competition is in Winston Cup, but anybody who's ever driven down the road behind a piece of heavy equipment that's bouncing on its tire, sitting there bouncing, they will understand that the tires have a spring rate. Well, race tires have a spring rate too, and you need to figure that into your spring rate of your whole car. In other words, you got chassis flex or lack of chassis flex, you got tire spring rate, and you got the spring rate of the spring that's actually in the car. So you need to know what kind of sidewall the tire's got. It's got a stiff sidewall or a soft sidewall, and you need to know the spring rate of the rubber belt that the radial tire has. And you can alter the spring rate of the belt. You can't do anything about the sidewall, but you can alter the spring rate of the belt by changing the pounds of air that's inside it. Pound of air is about 50 to 60 pounds difference in spring rate of the tire.
We really didn't see these minute adjustments on air pressure until the advent of the radial tire.
A long way from the old run what you run. Well, we appreciate that. Thank you, folks. Glad you're watching us on TNN Motorsports. We're coming back. We'll go to the garage also in a moment and hear from Ricky Rudd. Stay with us. Welcome back to New Hampshire and the CMT 300. You know how fortunes can change in this business, Glenn? Ricky Rudd wins the Brickyard, but since then he was 40th at Watkins Glen, 29th at Michigan, 19th at Bristol, 28th last week at Richmond, and he won't even finish today.
Oh, you're exactly right. Ricky, we were just talking about how bad your fortunes have been since winning the Brickyard. Things just haven't gone well. Another bad day here today. What happened?
Well, we were actually on the racetrack. We're about an eighth place car. We never could get track position all day. Everybody was pretty even today. And that last restart, Jeff Bodine seemed to be in a little bit bigger hurry than the rest of the field. And he dove in there three wide. Absolutely nowhere to go for him to go. And everyone else was being patient but him. And he dove in there and caused the big wreck.
They're working on the car right now. Are they going to try to get it back out?
Well, they're going to try to patch it up. It broke some oil lines underneath the car, sheared some lines on the car, and might have hurt the motor. We're not really sure. They're going to take a look at it, see if we can't get it back out there.
This was a car that you guys had built yourself. You'd worked on it all day. I know you made a lot of adjustments. How was it coming to you?
Well, it was okay. You know, it's the first time out of the box for it, and we debated about not racing it. This is just kind of an experimental year for us the rest of the year. And the car wasn't bad. Didn't qualify good, but like I say, it was fairly racy, seventh, eighth place car. Not too disappointed from that respect. Just you got to get qualified good on these short tracks because track position was everything today.
It's absolutely everything. Ricky Rudd had a great record here at New Hampshire. He had never finished out of the top 10. In fact, had four top five finishes. Not today.
No, not to be today. While we have a chance and track cleanup continues, remember Opryland USA. It's the official destination of NASCAR. And if you'd like more information, just call the number you see on the screen or log on at country.com and find out all about Opryland USA in Nashville, Tennessee. Let's take another look, guys, at the accident from the Todd Bodine in car.
Oh.
And he watched his brother and Ricky right in front there. Meanwhile, we talked before about Steve Grissom running in sixth spot after the pit stops back on lap 227. And Steve, they did a heck of a job.
Eli, they made a gas-only start. Now, Steve Grissom started this race 23rd, and coming into the race, he had but four top 10 finishes in the 97 season, so they're trying to improve that record here today. A gas-only stop. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
An update on Jeff Gordon. When you talk about teamwork, all you have to do is go back two races to go to the Southern 500. The Rainbow Warriors put Gordon in position to win on pit road with great pit work. They've done it again today. The captain, Mike Felden, great gas work. A great gas and go, 3.5 seconds. They have enough fuel now to go the distance. And Ray just told me, as soon as Jeff gets in his rhythm, he can drive away. The only guy they are worried about is the 28 car of Ernie Irvin.
Right now, they're putting down a lot of speedy dry on the racetrack. Someone's putting down some oil, and they're checking to see where it's coming from. We'll be right back. Well, track cleanup is now complete. They've gotten all the excess speedy drive pushed aside, so we are going racing. Lap 244 is complete on the board.
Ready, get ready,
if you're a David Green fan, he's back on the track also now.
Here we go. Green flag.
Listening to a number of the different teams and how they cue their drivers as to get back at it.
You can see a spotter just excited as the drivers do right now. They want them up front.
I want to know who cued the fans, because all of a sudden these cars get around the third and fourth turn for a restart, and everybody in this place rises to their feet, and they do it in unison every time.
It's like Judge Wapner walked in or something.
Somebody walked in.
Let's see what Jeff Gordon can do now as he holds off the challenge of Ricky Craven, Ted Musgrave, Ernie Irvin, and Bill Elliott. Steve Grissom is sixth, Mark Martin seventh, Dale Jarrett is eighth, Bobby Hamilton ninth, and Kyle Petty is tenth. Little there in the 97, the John Deere machine. He is in 30th spot, a couple of laps down. Has nowhere to go to get out of the way, though, right now.
So far, this appears to be a somewhat calmer restart than the last one we had. Don't see any free wide stuff going on.
We're riding with Mark Martin there for the moment.
Trying to get under Grissom down the front straightaway. These are all positions these guys are racing for right now. You see Mark Martin has nowhere to go. He's got a car on the outside, and Kenny Schrader on the outside. Grissom just in front of him.
Grissom fourth here in July. That was his career best finish. Same car, basically the same setup. Another nice run. Two in a row here at New Hampshire for Steve Grissom in that 41 car.
Of course, they should have had several top tens and a couple of top fives in the first half of the year.
Uh-oh.
A little touch of Bill Elliott. There goes Mark Martin.
Race and air for contact sport, no matter what they tell you.
That's for fifth spot, all of that exchanging going on.
That's over 120 miles an hour that contact is going on.
Whoa! That was Mark Martin and Bill Elliott rubbing just a little bit, getting in the corner there.
And fifth is up for grabs. You might have seen Dale Jarrett's car there wiggle in the middle of that bit with Bobby Hamilton behind it.
We're getting close to the end of this thing now, and every position counts. Nobody wants to get stuck on the outside.
If you are a Ricky Rudd fan, he is not going to be returning today. They looked the car over. Too much damage. The Tide team is calling it an afternoon.
What a rotten birthday present. His birthday was Friday, 41.
There goes Schrader way high to the wall. You see him up there outside the groove. And he's running 38th after starting on the push pole.
He's in a tough day today.
Yeah. Looks as though the Unical Challenge, that's the money that is up for the pole sitter should he win the race, roll over to $114,000 in time for our telecast from Dover next weekend in the MBNA 400. Dale Earnhardt and Kyle Petty in some tight battling there. That's for 10th spot.
It's getting pretty physical.
Yeah, it's getting pretty late in the day. Only 49 laps to go as they come across the stripe now.
Right here is a bunch of action going on. You see Ted Musgrave there. He's dropping back through the field just a little bit. Dale Jarrett going by him on the outside. Bobby Hamilton closing up. And Kyle Petty just behind him. But everybody here is taking the spot right now. They're not giving any quarters. You see Earnhardt on the outside there, driving very, very hard.
We're not forgetting the leaders. It is 0.6 seconds from Jeff Gordon back to second place Ricky Craven. It is then 3 seconds from Craven back to Ernie Irvin, and then all this other scrambling that we've been showing you here. Glenn Jarrett, what do you got there on Musgrave's car? He was running in the top handful before.
Oh, yeah, he's had a good car all day, Eli, but right now he's got either a battery or alternator problem. He's losing power. It seems like the battery's not putting out, so he's dropping back right now. He'll probably have to stop. I don't think he can make it the rest of the way.
That's too bad. Yeah, there's Ted. He's an 11th, and he's about to be bypassed the 12th and 13th and all the rest of those fellows you see there.
Nobody ever tried harder in this sport than Ted Musgrave, and nobody's ever had more disappointment either. Seems as if every time he gets really going well, something like this happens.
Ted Musgrave, no wins in this 209th career start for him.
What a happy day it'll be when that first one comes. And it will come.
Oh, no doubt. Of course, he was well behind the eight ball when the day started because our director, Gary Clem, threw him in the pool. And Gary never wins the pool.
Yeah, if they'd gone to Musgrave, he probably wouldn't have even started the event had he known that.
Here comes Ted Musgrave, not to make light of the situation. 254 laps on the board when he comes in to make his stop on the Family Channel Prime Star entrance. There you see now from fifth on back. Steve Burns, meanwhile, is watching the stop on Ted Musgrave's behalf.
Eli, we can see them reaching in behind Ted Musgrave. They have the car up on deck to the left side. Can't tell if it's under power or not. We'll get right back to you.
The crew going to work there. The battery, of course, if they have to change it, is not like your battery at home in a passenger car, is it, buddy?
No, no, and it's absolutely in front of the left rear wheel, and you have to take a plate off and reach up in there, and it's all wrapped in rubber insulation and everything else. It's a real tough job to get it out.
It really is. Ted Musgrave, we talked about having some disappointments, and there's his record with Roush Racing. But that's not a reflection on Ted Musgrave as a driver. One of the very best coming out of the Midwest. Great ASA and other racers, races up there in the upper Midwest. Now to Dale Jarrett, right there at Bobby Hamilton. That is for seventh spot. Bill Elliott just ahead of them in sixth. Earnhardt's in that equation, too. They're all running for position. So's Kyle Petty. So's Terry Labonte, who's right behind as well in 11th. That whole bunch right there. running fourth position.
When the driver's beating the out, we say, remember, guys, give and take out there. Sure, it looks like it's mostly kicking going on at the moment.
This is the corner of the raceway you take. You see, Garrett up under Bill Elliott as they head into turn three.
Oh, Brett Bodine is in the wall. Brett Bodine started third. Caution is on the speedway. Caution at lap 259 when they come on around. Brett Bodine went up and caught the wall coming out of turn number two, and we are under yellow. Boy, he was so excited. Brett was with us on our telecast yesterday, the doubleheader here of the NASCAR Busch North and the Featherlite Modified Tour races, and he was really psyched because they had qualified third and didn't hang there long, unfortunately. It was not a spectacular day for Brett.
Well, they put a lot of work in that car to try to make it as good as they possibly could. Car will be sold at the end of the year. They decided that this morning.
So that spin in turn number two brings out the caution for the fifth time. Lap number 259 on the board. We're live in New Hampshire.
Race and tying the King Richard Petty's all-time mark for the modern era of 13 wins. An interesting note, they have victories at seven of the eight tracks that remain on the 1997 schedule. And they would love to add that to their already stellar resume.
Nine wins to 15 for Fords as a unit here in 97. All right, green flag with 38 laps to go.
$3.7 million so far this year at age 26. Not bad.
Not bad at all.
My best year.
your whole career.
The leader, Gordon. You see Craven now in second, has been for a while. The third car in your picture is Dick Strickle. He is in
oh,
and all sorts of problems there in the middle of the pack.
We have a caution. We will have a caution.
No caution yet. No caution yet.
Chad Little right in the middle of all that. And the green and yellow car.
A little grass got kicked up on the track, but no other debris, we are told, by the NASCAR observers. And green staying on the speedway. And now second spot moving around. Here comes Ernie Irvin. He's caught Craven after getting around.
Oh, Craven is loose getting off turn four. Almost lost control. Here comes Ernie Irvin as they head down in turn one. He should make this pass without any trouble whatsoever.
Yeah, Irvin didn't look all that straight either for a little while.
Yeah, but he could drive. I'm going to tell you what. You talk about a guy that can manhandle a race car. Ernie Irvin is really, really good. When the car may be a little bit loose, he drives very, very well.
Now there's problems in turn two. Sterling Marlin. Terry Labonte with flame behind his car now. Midway on Terry's got a fire. A fire in the middle of the back stretch on Terry Labonte's car. There you see it right there, and he is going to be scampering out of the car as quickly as he can.
Boy, that thing is bent up.
Derek Cope got a piece of that as well. He just came by with a lot of smoke. The 37 was involved. Jeremy Mayfield. There you see Cope. A little smoke from behind Mark Martin also. Don't know if there was some sheet metal crunched in there. Lap 265. There you see Mark's car. And he's checking now. He's going back and forth. They had to clean off the tires as he went through the debris, but there was also some smoke as the body was shifting. And there's old Sterling.
Oh, that thing is wrecked.
He was already back in 34th, just finishing out the laps of the day. You see a little smoke, and Mark's still checking as he zigs and zags that car backwards and forwards.
Mandatory ride to the infield care center for Terry Labonte.
Back up here and show you everything that's taken place. First, the deal that did not bring out the caution. There's Chad Little and the rest in turn three and four.
He had to check up because of Grissom there, either run into him. You can see the four car there, Sterling Marlin getting involved.
Here it is again. From our look on the straightaway heading back. That is the second incident that took place just moments ago.
And involving the same group of cars. This is a crash that took place
Wow.
Well, here's where Terry's problem.
Yep.
You see Kyle trying to sneak through, and he has to tick off the wall.
That was nearly a one-lap accident.
You know what happens there? A lot of people wonder why the car catches on fire like that. You knock the fuel pump off the right-hand side of the motor, and as the gas just pours out, and that's what caused that fire there.
All the heat, of course. And there you see Glenn. They're trying what they can to fix that Kodak machine, we can see, but boy, they've got a lot of work.
Yeah, they do. It's definitely not a Kodak moment, not the kind they'd like to see. But it appears that the damage maybe just looks worse than it really is. Mostly sheet metal. From what I can see, they've got the sheet metal off the left rear tire. Working on the inside fender well right now, trying to keep it off. That's where most of the damage is. But I believe they're going to be able to get him up back out there. He won't be able to go very fast. The rear spoiler has been up in a little, it looks like one of those curly Q French fry things on the left side here. Not a very pretty sight, but I believe Sterling's going to be able to get back out. They're going under the hood right now. We'll have to check a little further, see what they're trying to do there. So we'll update you in a moment when we find out exactly what they're looking for.
There's Sterling, not having a fine year at all. Poor old Jeremy Mayfield, remember how good he was running? Now he's back in 27th position, already a lap down. Terry Labonte on the way to the infield care center. He was running in the lead lap in 11th. And you see Mark still checking. The spotters up on the roof with binoculars are looking to see exactly where they might be getting a little sheet metal rub or something. And of course, there you see the left rear crunched in just a bit. There's Chad Little. He was in the middle of the incidents at both ends of the racetrack as well. Well, we were just moving right along with one caution for the longest time. Now we've got six. We are still under caution. The CMT 300 was trucking along at record pace. Now it is the wreckers that are trucking along right now. Mark Martin, there you see him. He's still been checking. He's been asking other drivers and so on what it looks like. He's running an eight, and they were still seeing a little smoke off of, I'm sure, some sheet metal caved in somewhere. Let's go down to the Mark Martin pit for an update.
Well, Steve Mills on top of the pit box with some binoculars taking a look at the left front fender. Dale Earnhardt, a lap and a half ago, pulled up alongside and said he thought it looked good. So now they're confirming with Mark on the radio. I don't think they're going to come in, but they are still talking about it because you can see it is pretty close to rubbing.
It really is awfully close, and you'll all keep an eye on it. We are at lap 269, and folks, coming up, the third annual NASCAR family cruise aboard the Norwegian Cruise Line's Leeward ship. Here's Buddy Baker to tell you what it'll sound like.
Oh, yeah.
December 8th
through 12th. That means we're fixing to check out of here.
Winston Cup Racing Wives Auxiliary will be the beneficiaries of monies raised. Call 1-888-491-4950, heading to Cozumel, Mexico, and Key West, Florida. A lot of the drivers will all be on hand, ourselves with our families. It'll be a good time, so check it out at that toll-free number. There's Dale Earnhardt. Well, he's got some damage there, too.
He has
on the right front.
Yeah, right on the right front there, but the tire does not look like it's rubbing just a little bit. You see the shiny part on the front part of the three there.
Yeah.
But that'll probably be okay. It'll probably, as it wears the rubber down, quit rubbing quite so bad. Wow.
Martin's eighth, Earnhardt's ninth, so they're basically,
and
either one of them goes off, the other guy benefits.
See what they're doing? They're looking at the TV monitor on our telecast to see what they can see. Here's Mark Martin from his in-car. Oh, there he bumps Steve Grissom right there, or one moved in on the other. That's maybe where that damage came. Matt, anything further?
Well, Steve Mill looked at the binoculars, Dale Earnhardt's help, and the way it looks now, they are going to stay out. They don't think it's really that serious.
Now, of course, you don't want to give up track position. 30 laps to go. Field's getting the one-to-go signal, so we are going back to green the next time by. All of a sudden, the caution laps will mount up. We'll be around 35 or so, 36, maybe more than that before they do give them the green here. Setting it for you, Jeff Gordon is the leader, Ernie Irvin second, Ricky Craven is third, fourth is Steve Grissom, Dale Jarrett will restart in fifth, Bill Elliott sixth, Bobby Hamilton seventh, Mark Martin eighth, that man Dale Earnhardt restarts in ninth, Jimmy Spencer will go 10th. 11th is Rusty Wallace. Joe Nemechek will restart in 12th. 13th will be Bobby Labonte, Hutch Strickland 14th, Jeff Bodine 15th, Rick Mast will start 16th, Todd Bodine in for Jeff Burton, he'll restart in 17th, ahead of John Andretti 18th, late speed is 19th, Johnny Benson in 20th, and the final car on the lead lap is Kyle Petty, he'll restart in 21st. Ray Evernham, hoping his driver can pick off win number 10 of the year.
Restarts are so important right now. You see Dick Trickle on the inside there trying to make up a lap on the outside. Jeff Gordon needs a great start here so he can get down to that preferred line. You see him jump out there.
Trickle, the first man, a lap down in 22nd spot. Cannot stay with the 24 car on the restart. Laps to settle the CMT 300. The clouds rolling in over the top of the speedway now. The entire track in overcast.
Gordon, Urban, Craven have all cleared Dick Trickle now.
Seems to be a clean restart here. First time back under green. Terry Labonte has just come out of the infield care center. Let's check in with Glenn.
Terry, pretty scary looking wreck out there. You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. It's a tough deal. Too bad. The Kellogg Chevy was running pretty good. We had a terrible qualifying run, and I thought we were going to have a good finish there. And I don't know. It seems like every lap, the lap cars are always in the way, and somebody has to knock them out of the way, and they cause a wreck or spin in front of you. And they're on those restarts. So I got caught up in one of them.
Well, as you can see, he's okay, and we just saw Chad Little was involved in another spin. No caution again.
Indeed, we stay under green, but Chad did the 360 there on that John Deere machine.
Smoke coming off
Earnhardt. Smoke from Earnhardt. You see that?
Yep. Yep.
That tire rub we were speculating about. Oh, you see he's making him wiggle even some there?
That is a bad place to have a rub because the right front goes flat and you have no choice but right into the wall.
He's running in ninth, Earnhardt is, with 26 laps to go. That's him there to the outside, going around Skinner, following Mark Martin.
You see that smoke again as he decelerates heading into the corner. There it is, on the right front of Earnhardt's car.
You know, it looks like the initial turn, though. It may not be rubbing enough to really create a problem. Hopefully it is not.
Meanwhile, Steve Grissom got around Ricky Craven. You see right there, they had been side by side.
Look at Dale Jarrett come up in the 88 car. He's also in the safe.
MCI bringing you NASCAR timing and scoring across the top of the screen.
What a big day it would be for Steve Grissom should he be able to stay there. This would be his best career finish, but
contact.
And then some. Craven doesn't want to let him have his best career finish twice in a row here at New Hampshire. And look at this between the 88 and 25.
Dale Jarrett beginning to rumble. 24 laps to go.
Oh, but he got wide.
That's it. Couldn't stay down low. So Craven got by and it may open up. No. Thought Hamilton might be able to out-drag him on the main straightaway. Couldn't do it.
The grandstand is on its feet again.
Of a second from the race leader Gordon back to second place Ernie Irvin. Then it's 2.5 seconds further back. And watch this battle right there. No battle at all. Hamilton blows by Jarrett into turn three.
Here comes Phil Elliott in 94, moving right up on Jarrett also.
Up front, meanwhile.
It's less than a car left as they start off down the back straightaway. Look at Ernie Irvin driving that car for all this worth. Comes off the corner, bobbles just a little bit. What great straightaway speed. Look at that car go.
Look at the fans just yelling, screaming. That's typical of what we're seeing around this track.
Who do you figure he's cheering for? Could be either one. Could be
anybody.
I guess we know who he's cheering for now.
This man who is in ninth spot right now, Dale Earnhardt, trying to grab eighth away from Mark Martin if he can. There's Bobby Hamilton around Ricky Craven to move Hamilton to fourth. Meanwhile, as Dale Jarrett begins to move, Craven takes away the inside. And they are all now 3 seconds behind the leader. We see that battle, and there's the front two. A 3-second advantage for Gordon and Irvin. over third place on back. You might have seen him. Let's go through some smoke. Literally seconds ago, that man, Jeff Bodine, spins yet again. He spun back at lap 68. He was involved at lap 234, now at lap 285. So Jeff Bodine. And the QVC Ford bringing out the caution. Here's what happened off turn four. Round she goes. Kyle Petty was the man behind him. Don't know certainly from those pictures if Kyle was involved, but certainly it was the Mattel Hot Wheels car right behind. So there's caution. Jeff is going to make a pit stop. We're 15 laps from the finish here in New Hampshire. Most leader, who has now clinched the additional 5-point bonus for leading the most laps today, Jeff Gordon. So just continuing to pull away in his lead atop the NASCAR Winston Cup point standing. Wrapping up caution for the seventh time today. It was strange. We had gone just two laps. We've gone 198 laps with only two cautions. And in the final 102 laps, we have had five caution periods.
Eli, I used to really get nervous, like if you're up front and they have the double file restart, you really get nervous because that brings a lot of people that are fighting to get back in the lead lap up beside of you, and they have to race too. So everybody out there is trying their heart out to better themselves, and things happen.
If you're a Sterling Marlin fan, he's back on the track, 17 laps down. He's running in 40th. And how about a quick update on Jeff Gordon?
Well, Eli, there's a number of crew members up and down pit road that are from the Northeast and would love nothing better than to win here at their home track, Loudon. One of those guys, young Steve Letard, 18-year-old crew member on Jeff Gordon's team. The reason? His dad helps build chassis for Robert Yates Racing. They've had a little fun ribbing going on in the family the past few weeks. DJ won at Bristol, so his dad left a little hat from Victory Lane on his pillow. After Steve's team won the Winston Million, he put one of those brand spanking new Jeff Gordon $1 million bills on his dad's pillow. Well, the hat came back last week, and he said, you know what, a win here at Loudon is just about five, and we would love to do that today.
Well, we'll see what happens. The green flag is in the air. We're at lap 290, just 10 to go. Let's see if Ernie's got something for Gordon.
Well, he got hung up there with Trickle, but Gordon went a little wide getting off the corner. You see Ernie still right on his back bumper as they head down the back straightaway.
Four wide on the back stretch.
Look,
three wide
you.
Going in. Nice job.
You can see Skinner getting just a little bit loose there. Dale Jarrett really trying to get by him there.
Jarrett's in sixth, Skinner's in 29th, and Dale just got pinned in behind him. Now he and Earnhardt fourth position.
And the smoke appears to be gone from in front of Earnhardt's car. The problem he had a little bit earlier seems to have gone away.
Jarrett hangs on to sixth. Oh, whoa. There goes Johnny Benson into the wall in turn number one. No caution. Johnny was running 19th on the lead lap. We're staying green.
Look at Bobby Hamilton here in 43, sideways off the corner, running very, very well.
Oh, and here goes Skinner. He spins. Oh, and he's going to take out others. And Rennie gets a piece of Michael Waltrip. Kenny Schrader's in there. We're at lap 291. They will certainly be able to get the racetrack cleaned, but here comes a good scramble back to the straight.
Boy, oh boy, this could be it. You see Ernie Irvin doing everything he can trying to get by Gordon as he comes into play.
Caution on the speedway, and there's Skinner still slipping and sliding around at lap 291. Schrader, we told you, was involved in some of that. Andretti got some. He just did tick Michael Waltrip in the number 21 machine. There's Michael. And he had a good day going, too, at times. He'd been up and down, running in 27th now.
What a lot of smoke all of a sudden. Boy, there's some cars that have been awfully badly beaten up here in the last few laps.
A lot of carnage.
Yeah.
Seeing that Skinner car here,
looking
smoke inside, just from the outside smoke blowing inside the car.
You can tell he is not one happy fella at the moment. Good qualifying run for Skinner.
Now, of course, on the restart, and we should have one because there is limited debris here on the main straightaway. We're now inside the final 10 laps, so only the lead lap cars are going to restart at the front, and then only in single file formation. So we won't have that double file to deal with here when we do go back racing. Kenny Schrader, push-pull sitter, so excited here Friday afternoon. Heck, on our telecast this afternoon when we began, he was awfully excited.
He's won some races so far this year, too. No Winston Cup. Won an ARCA race in Toledo, California, Winston West. He won a race in Anderson, Indiana, also a dirt modified race, but he said, I can't remember where that one was, but he knows he won it. Doing some barnstorming, but not having much fun here this afternoon in Loudoun.
We've gotten some great shots today from the DuraShine aerial camera. DuraShine Advanced Auto Polish. Just wipe it on and hose it off. DuraShine is now available at Pep Boys, Western Auto, Kmart, and Target Auto Stores.
You can see the left front on the 21 there. He has no brakes, we understand. And the left front is just not working at all. It's locked up as he goes around through here. You see that? Just dragging it right from that.
Track cleanup is now done, so we'll be going back to green, certainly. Here again is the incident from high above the speedway. Watch 98, Andretti. Michael had nowhere to go. Schrader plows into the rear. Your basic chain reaction. Here it is again, Bill Elliott. Right behind Skinner there, once Mike came off the wall. You know what amazed me? Look how quickly Andretti reacted. Even though he did get into some other folks, he was right behind Skinner and like on a dime.
You're exactly right. He was up on that steering wheel and he did the right thing.
Watch that again here on this replay. Watch how quickly once Skinner goes, how quickly 98.
Looks like Bill got into the 31 of Skinner just a little bit. Bill Elliott, you can see Rusty Wallace getting by on the inside. Quite a few got through there. Todd Bodine's been through every wreck out there today in the 99 car. He's showing just a little damage on the back part where somebody's run into him, but nothing to really hinder his progress.
He's running 15. Watch this. Oh, right into your living room. And remember, Mike Skinner's got an in-car camera, too.
Oh. And the hits just keep coming.
Man, that's something. Steve Burns has an update on all that's going on down there.
Yeah, as you said, Eli, Michael Waltrip came down. Johnny Benson was just in. They changed left side tires. The left rear corner of that car is crumpled in. They took the sledgehammers out, tried to bang it out, but he's going to get out there and try and limp around.
We are at lap 294 of 300, and again, the leader is that man, Jeff Gordon. They are coming back out here on the main straightaway. You'll see from this view, just look out to the right of the screen, the pace car will go by the cleanup truck that is right there putting down speedy dry. They've come back out to put some more down. We're now at lap 294, which means we're looking at no more than four laps of racing if they give them the one to go the next time by. And we are winding down.
That speedy dry appears to be down low on the racetrack, so that should not present a problem. The upper grooves appear to be clean.
Let's go back to the Jeff Gordon pit now.
Well, I'll tell you what, Eli, looking at Ray Evernham, Michael Landis checking us, I think I see some gray hair showing. These guys are almost going into cardiac arrest because about every 10 laps, a caution comes out, and it allows Ernie Irvin to close and get one more chance on a restart to get around him. I tell you what, it could be a long afternoon. One guy told me, he goes, I think we've had 10 to go for about an hour and a half now. I don't know, is it me or you?
It seems that way. We've got 295 on the board now. I tell you, there's a lot of speedy dry out there.
It is, Eli. There's quite a bit getting into turn one down there. And, you know, the leader has to go through there first. They'll get as clean as they possibly can, but everybody's going to have to walk very carefully through first and second turn.
What's going on with Gordon in the pace car?
And the other thing I'm going to tell you, if they go back under green and have a good run here, Ernie Irvin showed me a lot of muscle. He pulled all the way up to the door on Jeff Gordon coming to the flag there just before the yellow flag was displayed to the leader.
Buster Otten at the wheel of the pace car. There he is on the right of the screen. Has some riders with him today from the NASCAR official family. My 296 is on the board now. 296. So that means they would get the one to go if they do at 297. We'd go racing at 298. So we are winding down to the final few laps. Don't forget, folks, if you're into video games, you've never seen anything like the TNN Motorsports Hardcore 4x4. It's for the Sony PlayStations and the Sega Saturn system. They say it is the most realistic type of racing video game you will see. Check it out, TNN Motorsports Hardcore 4x4 for the Sony PlayStations and the Sega Saturn system. Or just go online at country.com and you can get yourself all the information online. There's the running order.
And don't you just know that Ernie Irvin would like to see that green flag come as soon as possible? He has been so fast all afternoon. He's not going to get by Jeff Gordon in a heartbeat, especially with a restart.
Don't forget Bobby Hamilton. That was a very fast car, and with just a few laps to go, the tires will stay cool. He'll be a factor.
Michael Waltrip going back to the garage.
Too bad for
Michael.
Yeah. Tried to get by. Just couldn't. Got kind of caught up in all that was going on. Fields getting the one-to-go signal right now. Don't forget, as soon as we leave the air, NHRA Winston Drag Racing, the Keystone Nationals, from Reading, Pennsylvania, Bob Fry is at this very moment clearing his throat, getting set to bring you all the coverage here on TNN Motorsports. So stick around. That's as soon as we sign off the Pioneer Keystone Nationals from Reading. Now remember, 10 laps or less to go. It is a restart that is single file and only the cars on the lead lap. They're going to come around and get the green at lap 298 of 300. This will end up being a six-lap caution period, and all of a sudden we're up to 49 laps of caution. We had gone, for the longest time, just seven laps of yellow, and now we're at 49 laps of caution.
That ties the record.
Yeah.
What kind of drag racer are you? You know how important this restart is? Every driver out there knows.
Old Todd Bodine doing a super job subbing for Jeff Burton. He just got a quick look at Todd. He's running now in 16th. Like Buddy's been telling you, he's gone through every one of those accidents today.
Most sports you get some score as the game goes on. In this sport, the score comes right at the very tail end. Here it is, the whole ball of wax, what they've been doing here the whole week long, getting the cars ready, the whole race.
Steve Grissom dropped back just a little bit. He's trying to get a little bit of a run on.
Here we go. Waving, two laps to go. That's 298. 299 next time by, and then lap 300 will be done.
Gordon got a good start.
He sure did. Going through all that speedy drive.
Earnhardt on the bottom looking for position.
He's losing position down on the bottom. Both Garrett and Jimmy Spencer got by him on the outside there.
To go, Jeff Gordon. Rusty Wallace is in the wall here on the main straightaway. Caution is on the speedway. They are racing around to the win. Caution and white is being displayed. That's the battle for the win.
Jeff Gordon just has turn three and four to get through. Very smooth through there. You can see 28 cars open. Trying to close in.
He's not going to be close enough. Ray Evernham knows it's in the bag. Win number 10 of the year for the Rainbow Warriors. Jeff Gordon becomes the first repeat winner at New Hampshire International Speedway. Having won in 1995, he doubles it up here this afternoon, winning the CMT 300. Heck of a finish. Under caution and the checkers, it was a full-speed finish with the yellow waving. We'll be going to victory lane. Rusty Wallace has driven away, if you're caring and concerned there. Rusty obviously fine. He is driving back around to the garage area as he tags the wall. He'll unofficially come home in 21st spot. Gordon about to climb from the race car in victory lane. Those of you tuning in for the Pioneer Electronics Keystone Nationals will be going drag racing in just a moment or so, but right now we go down to Glenn Jarrett. We've seen this before.
Oh, yeah, we have, and we've seen it 10 times this year. Jeff, great run, but the CMT 300 had to seem like 600 there.
Oh, man, at least those last, 50, 60 laps, I tell you, I never thought we could hold off Ernie, and I'm not sure if the cautions were good or bad, but this team is great. They made a great call doing that gas and go. I questioned it every once in a while, but I tell you what, Ray makes excellent decisions. This team did a great job in the pits, and I tell you that outside groove was the way to go because it was so slick down the bottom that, I just stuck it up there on the high side, trying not to get too high. I got to thank DuPont Automotive Finishes, Quaker State. Goodyear had a great tire today. Chevrolet, boy, brought the Chevrolet into victory lane again. It's pretty unbelievable.
Well, it is unbelievable. 10 wins already this year. Got a lot of good racetracks coming up for him. We'll let these other guys say their congratulations to him. Jeff Gordon in his 10th win.
And with Ernie Irvin, who finished second. Ernie, just short on the restarts, what happened?
Well, I mean, Jeff, anytime the guy's starting on the front, he has a little bit better shot to get clear. And it took me a while to get going again. And, Jeff was just a little bit better race car at that time. We had a great race car. This Texaco Avalon Ford did a good job. And, all the guys did a good job on pit stops. It just fell a little short.
All right, thanks, Ernie. Back to Glenn in victory lane.
Well, thanks, Steve. Ray Evernham has come in. And, Ray, you guys get the Miller Lite Pit Crew Award again for the, 3,918th time this year. Congratulations. You didn't have the best car to begin with, but you guys got it right in the end.
Well, we worked on it, got a great crew, and we really appreciate Miller supplying these awards. I know it means a lot to the guys, and I want to thank God. He gives us the opportunity to do this. But, it's just a great team. I'm really lucky to be part of it. And Jeff really makes up for a lot. You can make some gutsy calls and do some things when you got a driver like that. And it's just an awesome day. This was a good win for us. We really didn't think we could come back and win here because we didn't run here real good in July. But it's a real good feeling, and we really appreciate this award.
Congratulations again to the whole team. Let's go back up top to Eli Gold.
That award brought to you by Miller Lite, who invite you to sit back and enjoy Miller time. Well, let's show you what happened just as they were coming to the white flag. And actually, the leaders have taken the white flag. Let's go back and see what happened to old Rusty Wallace. There he is in the two.
Trying to get down. Hutt Strickland was right there.
Yeah, Hutt was there.
Yep, tagged his left rear fender. Boom, into the inside retaining wall he went.
And Rusty does come on around after the two spins to finish in 21st position. Well, it is all said and done. The CMT 300 belongs to Jeff Gordon. We're back to wrap it up after this. And Bobby Hamilton, his first top five in 17 races, Matt.
Well, he's also excited about the fact that that 43 car barely has a mark on it. How wild was that two-lap shootout?
It was pretty neat. I'm sure the fans enjoyed themselves. All the viewing audiences watching the TV, I'm sure they enjoyed it, but the stage ride was everywhere, man. I seen Gordon when he went in there. He looked like he was swatting flies, and I seen Ernie swatting flies, and I said, they're in trouble. Then I went in there, and he looked like I was swatting flies. So we were just holding on all we could do. They put the stage ride on the bottom. The bottom was my groove. They run a little high, and that hurt us a little bit. But I tell you what, we led a lot. We fell back. We decided to, run a conservative race and be there at the end, and that's what we did, and it turned out good.
They fought back for a good top five today.
It was in the 15th time this year that Pontiac has led an event. Let's take a look at how your favorites did. Dale Jarrett comes home there in sixth. Jimmy Spencer seventh. Earnhardt in eighth. So now on to Dover with a streak now of 52 races since last he won.
And Steve Grissom equals his career best with a fourth place finish. Ricky Craven with a fifth place finish. Good run for him.
Jeff Bodine had his lumps today, but he came home in 16th. Lake Speed in 18th.
Well, you can see right there, Jeff Burton did a wonderful job soldiering along there. Was in countless times he could have really torn the car up, did what he had to do, brought him home a lot of points.
Right, Todd Bodine doing a great job for that Jeff Burton effort here today. There you see the next group, Darrell Waltrip, Brett Bodine, who started third, had problems today. Then the fellows who were involved in accidents or spent a good bit of time behind the wall or in the garage area, and then the first out of the event, Robert Presley. As far as NASCAR Winston Cup points are concerned, here's how it all shakes out following today's running of the CMT 300. 139 points now the spread. Jeff Gordon over Mark Martin. Heading on to Dover, Delaware, and that's where we will be next weekend. Hope you can join us. Our coverage will come your way on Saturday for the NASCAR Busch Series, the MBNA 200, and then Sunday a week from today, 12 noon Eastern, the MBNA 400, down to 400 laps, 400 miles at the Monster Mile coming up next Sunday. In just a moment, Bob Fry, Steve Evans, and the crew will be joining you with the Pioneer Electronics Keystone Nationals. That is next from Reading, Pennsylvania, right here on TNN Motorsports. A big thank you to Dr. Dick Bergman, to Buddy Baker, Glenn Jarrett, Matt Yoakum, Steve Burns. I'm Eli Gold. Hope you enjoyed our coverage from New Hampshire this weekend. We'll see you next weekend in Dover, Delaware. Again, stay tuned. NHRA Winston Drag Racing coming up next, the Pioneer Electronics Keystone Nationals. But for now, we're out of here in New Hampshire. Jeff Gordon is the winner. So long from TNN Motorsports.